Good evening and very warm welcome to the 2022 British Cycling National Track Championships from Newport in South Wales. Again, our thoughts and prayers go out to all those in Ukraine, but for now we are in the Geraint Thomas Velodrome bringing you live coverage over the weekend as we see the competitors battle it out for the coveted national stripes. This is session four. We're going to see men's sprinting, women's keyring, women's scratch race and men's points. I'm Brian Smith and I'm joined with by Rebecca Charlton, former championship competitor, and we guide you through the weekend's events. We have Olympic, world, European and former national champions here, the stars of the future also. So sit back and enjoy. Rebecca, what else is there to do on a Saturday night?
Nothing else to do on a Saturday night, Brian. This is it. We're back at the national championships. We had a year of, unfortunately, very difficult times with COVID, and it postponed the Olympics, of course. Then postponement happened for other events, including this championships. But we are here. We're live from the Velodrome, the Geraint Thomas track here in Wales. And you can just see the light shows going off here in the track and the stands starting to pack out for this evening session and lots of finals coming up.
Yeah, I was actually told that this is one of the very few velodromes that are able to do these kind of light shows. Most can't. So, with a few seconds of that, we will be going straight into the semi-final of the sprinting. Same colours, the green colours of Team Inspired. And without the moustache is Jack Carling from Paisley. Lovely place. And
great part of the world.
Yes. Hayden Norris. So this is the best of three. First across the line after three laps will win the first leg of this three-leg race. It could go to a decider, but Jack Carlin has really showed over these championships so far that he is the fastest. But can Hayden Norris outmaneuver him, outfox him? You never know.
Anything is possible in the match sprint as it gets underway now. And for anyone just joining us for the coverage, eagle-eyed among you might have noticed that the coach holding up Jack Carlin looked very familiar indeed, albeit behind a mask, and that was in fact Jason Kenny, who recently announced his retirement and has now, happily for the sport, joined the ranks of the coaching squad.
So Jack Carlin at the front has to lead off. They have to do at least walking pace for the first half lap. And then you'll see them start to wind this up. So I see a very cagey start to this one. Like you say in track sprinting, when you get to this stage, you know, fatigue comes in. They've had quite a few sprints already today. We've had a break for 2 or 3 hours, and now they're back on the track. It's backing up your performances that you did earlier on today. So this is a really kind of slow, cagey affair. Obviously, they respect, they know each other, and I think that Hayden Norris at the back here knows that he's up against possibly the favourite for this championship.
He certainly does, and you do have to try everything in this tactical game of cat and mouse. And obviously you can see from the kit that they're in, that they're riding in and on, is that their teammates, they know each other very, very well, Team Inspired, in fact, and we saw them all smash their way through qualification. But Jack Carlin, favourite on paper, fastest 200-metre qualifier earlier today, and his opponent is going to do everything to outsmart him.
Well, he likes to play, doesn't he, Jack? Not frightened of doing anything, just holding him up, and he wants to hold him up. He does not want Hayden to lead this one out. This is a really cagey one, so the bell is going to ring. Hayden goes up, Hayden Norris goes with the pace to the top, but Jack Carlin inside the last 200 metres, inside that sprinter's line, out the saddle, down the back straight, into turn three, into turn four, and he does have the power to go all the way. No contest this one. Jack Carlin goes 1-0 up.
1-0, best of three, but if the same rider takes two, of course, it doesn't need to go to a decider. So if Jack Carlin takes the next one, he's won that best of three. But he's got that ability to inject the pace and then just do another acceleration, as we saw there.
Looking at the way Jack Carlin has progressed through these championships, it does say to me, you really have to take this one on from the front and come into that final straight with some sort of advantage, but it's easier said than done. And you can see that Jack Carlin didn't want that to happen, didn't want Hayden Norris to go round him, and you know, was very astute, switched on as you have to be, and strong performance as expected from Jack Callan to go 1-0 up. Back to the boards for Norris, but it's going to be very difficult against the hot seat. But moving on to Joe Truman and Hamish Turnbull, I would say quite an even battle in this one.
Yeah, and that's the interesting element that we've got this evening. For anyone that missed the earlier coverage, we saw these rounds take place, and the seeding was originally done by a flying 100-metre time trial, and then we saw the match sprints, eventually C-team inspired, all going up against each other in the finals that we're about to see this evening.
Well, Truman and Turnbull, both of them very, very similar. Truman at the front here, Turnbull behind, both on pretty much identical equipment. So Truman having to lead this one out. So what's Turnbull going to do? Truman keeping an eye on his opponent. And looks like Truman also, we've seen this in the quarterfinals, he likes to take this one on from the front. He's maybe slightly taller and using those long levers to some great advantage.
Well, there's an advantage and disadvantage of being teammates looking at each other very, very closely indeed, because they've done a lot of drills, a lot of training together. They know what they're likely to do, and Joe Truman wanted to get the pounce.
Well, Turnbull is on the wheel. He's going into that slipstream. Can he catapult himself? This is going to be a drag race up the finishing line. This is going to be close.
I think it's
Truman that gets that right in the inside. Told you it was going to be close.
You called that one, Brian. It looked like Truman definitely got that one. We'll wait for confirmation, of course. Very, very fast finishes in the match sprint. 68.298 kilometres an hour as we just get a replay of that run to the line. Truman just holding him on the shoulder there.
Yeah, it was a good effort there from Turnbull on the outside, but he came the longer way. You can see that Truman was on the Côte d'Azur. Can't really ride there, so we'll have to kind of wait and see what the commissaires say. But for me, Truman gets that one and goes 1-0 up. You know, he did this in the quarterfinals. He wanted to take all the sprints on from the front, use his long levers to his advantage, get up to speed. Very difficult to come round, but Hamish Turnbull doing a good job there, and Truman goes 1-0 up.
And it did look that Turnbull might not have run out of time along that finishing straight to get him back, but actually you just saw on that replay how much Joe Truman just pushed the bike forward yet again. And we've talked often about these lunges to the line. It wasn't such a lunge, but you just saw him shift it up again, which is not easy to do in that run into the line. But a very close sport match, two riders that know each other very well and had to pull everything out of the bag.
Well, we're going to move on now as they're lining up for the women's Kieran racing, and the Derny comes out. Well, they used to have a diesel Derny way back in the day. Now it is an electric Derny. So in the first heat we've got...
I think we might be running on diesel today, Brian, by the sounds of it.
Maybe it's just a... Yeah, right.
Back to the original, and we can hear it and we love that sound.
Old school. But yeah, the Derny is out on the track. We have four heats. We have two heats of five to start with, two heats of six. And just for a little bit of housekeeping, the winner of each of these rounds will go straight into the semi-final. All the losers, i.e. everybody that's not first, goes into the repechages, so they get another opportunity to come back. So for the moment, if you want to do lesser racing, then you want to try and guarantee, which I think for a qualifying round, that's quite a bit of pressure. If you don't want to ride in the repechage, which means that you don't get a buy into the semi-final, you have to ride again to try and get into the semi-final. You really want to win this one, don't you?
You do, and as you say, we refer to that as losers to repechage, but actually it's a very tall task to be the winner of that round early on in the competition to automatically qualify to get through to the semi-final. So it's going to be a very hard-fought battle, and then the period is such an unpredictable discipline as well. These are going to be really, really tough rounds, and you're not going to be able to sit back in this competition whatsoever and look around you. It's a case of, as you say, if they want to conserve some energy, they have to go for that win in the qualification.
So in this heat, you have Ioana Adesina, Lauren Bell, Rihanna Paris-Smith, Lucia Steele and Lowry Thomas. So a bit of red in here, but the Lowry Thomas is the Welsh rider. And these riders have already been seeded, and they'll place themselves in that seeded order, and they have to stay in that seeded order until the Derny pulls off with three laps to go.
They do, so it's worth for anybody joining the coverage now who's perhaps not followed the rules closely of Derny racing. We're of course seeing the Derny motorised vehicle, albeit pedalled, to keep it a very smooth and consistent increase in pace. The riders will have to stay behind that Derny until three laps to go. And we have seen some rule changes in that now where you pull a luck of the draw, you have to sit in that order behind the Derny motorbike on the track. And in previous years, I think previous to 2017, we would have seen riders on the hip, giving each other a nudge, trying to move around and jostle, which made this some very interesting racing on the boards. But we do see them have to stay in that position now as the motorbike gets them up to pace of about 45k an hour before peeling off with three to go.
Well, we're getting close to that point, and it's Lucia Steele who's behind the bike. Everybody looking behind, and then it comes off with three laps to go, and this is the thing about the modern Kieran. Nobody really wants to take it on with three laps to go. So Lucia Steele on the front, and then you have Lowry Thomas in second place. Black line Lauren Bell coming down the outside to gain position, and they'll come up to two laps to go. So the reminder that you don't want, if you don't want another Kieran race, you want to try and win this one down the outside. You can see Ioana Adesina trying to come down, I was going to say in the red, but it's coming up to the bell. You've got Lauren Bell with Lucia Steele on the wheel. The rest have been distanced ever so slightly. Lucia Steele trying to come round the long way around the outside. Going to be very difficult, so holding the black line, you got Lauren Bell. Lucia Steele trying to come round to the outside. Can she do it? No, she can't. And Lauren Bell takes that. So Lauren Bell guarantees her way through into the semi-final. The other riders of Ioana Adesina, Rihanna Paris-Smith, Lucia Steele and Lowry Thomas will have to go into a repechage. And in the repechage, it'd be the first and second places that will go into the semi-final.
So when we're looking at these heats, we've got the benefit of many of them having done the 200-metre flying TT against the clock yesterday that seeded them for the individual sprint, the match sprints we saw yesterday. And so it's given me an interesting gauge of how we might expect people to fare in tonight's Kieran, because quite a lot of the field's the same. So Lauren Bell of Blackline, you just see her coming around the outside now and injecting that pace to take it on from the front. And she was actually the fastest qualifier out of all the riders in this heat. So she came fourth in quali yesterday for the sprint with a time of 11.044. So on paper, she was the fastest there, but she also played that very, very tactically astute.
Yeah, I think it's worth noting that Lauren Bell, with that experience in this competition, came round at the right time. Lucia Steele grabbed the wheel but tried to come down on the straight, but didn't have enough power to surpass the strong ride of Lauren Bell there. So all four riders that apart from Lauren Bell will not go through automatically to the semi-final. So on to the next heats, Emily Burgess of SES Racing, Rhianne Edmonds, the new sprint champion, local girl, only lives 15 minutes up the road, Serena Natt of the Wales Racing Academy, Ellie Stone of Black Line, and Jodie Taylor of Team Terminator.
So as you say, getting off the start line there, the Derny just getting in front and the riders forming their seeded places, whilst they seeded the draw that they've done earlier. Rhianne Edmonds taking the title yesterday in the sprint, becoming the newly crowned national champion of the sprint event as an individual. So yeah, coming into the Kieran today, she's had some big recovery overnight.
Well, she's on the Derny now, and and I think she'll be happy with the placing she got. It's all seeded before they come out, so they can't change around. So the new British sprint champion is the rider behind the Dernie, the 18-year-old from Newport. And then we have got Jodie Taylor. And then we go to Serena Natt from Wales. Further back from the Team Terminator, just moving up now. A lot of red in this field.
There certainly is. We'll help you to pick out some of these team kits as we go on throughout tonight's action. But we are seeing a lot of red, redskin suits with black shorts there for Team Wales, Team Breeze, SES. And we'll be picking all those kits out for you there. But that's the Welsh kit on the front there.
So Edmonds is propped on the front here. You know, I wouldn't think she's done a lot of this kind of tiering racing, but if you've not got the experience, just, you know, we know she's got the strength from the sprints, just take it on from the front, which she's doing, keep out of trouble. We saw Lauren Bell in the previous heat coming over the top. You've got Nat starting to come round. So we're down the back straights, and they'll get the bell the next time round.
Yeah, Serena Nat had a couple of really good rides yesterday, actually, and really showing her strength in the sprint event as an individual, and she's taken it on from the front there, but Edmonds doesn't want to let her have it.
Yeah, she doesn't want to relinquish that spot. Nat in the bottom of the track trying to kind of hang on here, but Edmonds looks so strong, just like she did in the sprint competition, coming down the straight, and wins that by about 3 bike lengths. Super performance from Edmonds, goes straight into the semi-finals, and she looks good for the second day in a row.
Interesting to see the performance of Serena Nat, the rider that you can just see at the front there at the moment, who did take it on from the front, just in second position on the screen. She'll want to come back through that repechage, of course, but no one could get quite on terms with that gap of Rhian Edmonds of Team Wales. After a sterling day yesterday, she's backed up that performance, recovered well, and come back for this heat of the Kieran.
But then you have the results. Rhian Edmonds will go straight through to the semi-final. And then you have Emily Burgess, Serena Natt, Ellie Stone and Jodie Taylor will go into the repechage. So heat three, we have six riders in this one. A little bit more difficult. We have Lauren Booth, Elizabeth Brifton, Sophie Capewell, Amy Cole, Ellie Costa and Iona Moyer of SES Racing. Another bit of red to conjure with. You're waving at the Kieran.
I love a lot of things about the Kieran, but what I love is the heritage of it and how it originated in Japan and was a betting sport, wasn't it, Brian? And we've seen some of the best of British Kieran riders, the likes of Becky James, going over and training in Japan to get that tactical nous and bring that back to the boards of the UK. But it's a fascinating sport. And for anyone watching for the first time, you've got a motorised vehicle on the track, the riders jostling behind. It's a spectacular one for spectators.
So this is the third heat, one more to come. Six in this one. I think it's a little bit easier to spot Elizabeth Broughton from Sports Fellow and Lauren Booth from PDQ Cycling Coaching. Elizabeth Broughton is sitting in second wheel. Lauren Booth is the rider at the back.
So we've got Sophie Capewell of Team Breeze, the fastest on the boards to qualify yesterday with a 200 flying metre time trial time of 10.968. Just two riders, her and Rhian Edmonds, going under 11 seconds. So she'll really want to come back strong today after taking silver and really wanting to defend gold yesterday.
Well, it's Iona Moyer. It's for SES Racing. It's on the Dernie at the moment, followed by Broughton. It peels off now, and like the other rounds, getting very cagey. Nobody really wants to take this one out, three laps out. Moyer thinking about it. Broughton just behind. but leaving a gap. This is a little bit more cagier than the previous two rounds.
Yeah, I quite often talk about who's fastest on paper and who's put down what time, but essentially the keyring can just come down to who tactically gets it right on the day. So often some riders like to come from the front, go long, other riders want to observe from the back, and that's what we're seeing play out here.
Well, Capewell, the one with experience and, you know, good result yesterday in the sprint, takes this one on from the front, but she's going to be have competition from the riders behind, but can she hold on to this? She's looking good at the moment.
She's looking good, it looks measured.
Into the final straight, looks behind, and it's an easy roll over the line, and it will be on to the semi-final for Sophie Capewell of Team Breeze. The rest will go into the repechage and try and get back into that semi-final, but it was quite easy. She came round with, well, it's just on the bell lap there, and you know, used the power to come down that finishing straight to secure that place. Ayuna Moya of SES Racing was second place, but second was as good as third, fourth, fifth, because they all go through into the repechage. Yeah. So there you have it: Capewell, Moya, Cole, Costa, Booth, and Broughton.
Yeah, Sophie Capewell will be very happy with how she managed to ride that to perfection to get herself through, not wanting to come through the repechage. But just a reminder for anyone just joining us, that repechage does give an opportunity for the rest of the riders that didn't take that automatic win to qualify for the semi-finals to come back through.
So this is the last of the heats of the women's keirin. This will be Emma Finucane, Stephanie Hall, Sylvia Mistal, Charlotte Robinson, Charlotte Sheridan, and Anna Whitworth-Hay.
Emma Finucane putting down 11.032 yesterday in her fine 200 qualification, taking third fastest overall, seeding her into the sprint competition for the day for Team Wales, and another red kit to look out for there. Riders in this heat that also rode in the sprint as the individual event that took place yesterday was Stephanie Hall and Anna Whitworth-Hay, who's again in the lead of SES Racing.
So on the Derny is Charlotte Sheridan of Torelli Cayman Islands, and she's followed by Emma Finucane of Team Wales. As you said, Rebecca did tremendously well yesterday in the sprint competition. And then Anna Whitworth-Hay from SES Racing Team. And then we have Stephanie Hall of Wales Racing Team. Glasgow Track Racing Team have Sylvia Mistel just towards the back, the last, second from last rider. Then on the back is Charlotte Robinson from the University of Nottingham.
So as the journey winds things up to around 45 kilometres an hour, the style that they pedal with on that motorised vehicle, allowing them to just measure that pace. The riders have to stay behind until the legal point where that journey pulls off, but you can see them already just starting to look around and think about that positioning and just how they're going to try and go for that win to get through automatically to the semi-final.
Well, Sheridan was behind the bike. She didn't want to take this on and, you know, left it up to Finucane. Round the outside, we're starting to see Stephanie Hall coming up. Still a bit early to go, two laps to go now. Finucane in the best place now, she's just sitting and waiting. She decides that she wants to get that front spot. Coming round the outside is Sylvia Mistel of Glasgow. But it's going to be Finucane battling it out here. Finucane trying to come over the top. This is actually Stephanie Hall at the front here. So Stephanie Hall in the lead position, and she's going to steal this one. Steals it from Anna Finucane. Stephanie Hall wins that one, goes straight into the semi-final. And Finucane, who did so well yesterday in the sprints, she was in the perfect position, but she just didn't have the power coming down the finishing straight here. And an excellent ride by Stephanie Hall here from the Wales Racing Academy. to go straight into the semi-final. So
super strong ride from Stephanie Hall, and taking it on from the front again, saw that acceleration, and then she went again, holding Emma Finnegan off, who actually qualified much higher in the 200 yesterday. And yeah, she's come back really, really fighting for that, automatically going through very convincingly on that replay there, and with an automatic entry to that semi-final.
I think she has to be really happy with that. She looks powerful, and she was powerful. Maybe this is her discipline, and this is what she's put everything into. Finnegan yesterday was riding well in the sprints, but we're moving swiftly on to the men's sprints semi-final. This is the second leg. Jack Carlin and Hayden Norris. Carlin already 1-0 up. This is the second of the legs, best of three. Carlin on the outside, adjusting, just putting his visor on. Norris with it all to do in the inside. Total concentration here. How do you think this is going to go, Rebecca?
Well, do you want me to go for my predictable answer? If Jack Carlin takes this one, it'll be over for this match sprint, because it's best of three, unless Jack Carlin takes this one, in which case, of course, they won't need the decider. But yes, I mean, I'm going to have to go with Carlin after seeing his performances yesterday and so far today. But these guys, as I've said before and I'll say again, they do know each other well. They do train together. And yeah, no one's going to, you know, give in without a fight here.
Well, I think if Norris winds this up from the qualifying of the sprint yesterday, the fastest rider is at the back. So this is probably a tactic of Norris. Keep it slow. I think he'll want to keep it slow. And hopefully he'll leave it as a late sprint, you know, as late as possible. And you're trying to take it on from the front. You know, that's what I was trying to do, because for Jack Carlin, he'll want it to be faster. Wound it up because he's proven that he's already the fastest. So Norris just slowing things down, not winding it up. I think Jack wants to get on with it, trying to cajole him. But no, Norris just has to stay calm. Down the back straight here, and we'll come round the next time. See that wee effort there? He's tried to coax Norris to go. He wants to go. He's twitching to go, but not. Norris is doing the right thing. He comes underneath him, holds him up, holds him up. Jack loves doing all these things.
Possibly a mistake. These riders.
Possibly a mistake. He wanted to take on from the front. He left the door open. Jack came through it, pushed him up, but this is a carbon copy of the previous rounds. Into turn three, he will have the power in the finishing straights to come all the way. He's going to put up a fight, it's Norris, but it's not going to be enough.
So really good fight from Norris there.
He had to. He just left that kind of door open, and Jack came through it. And, you know, when Jack takes it on from the front, it's very hard to get round him. So that was the moment there. Just left the door open, Jack, bang, went through the door, held him up, and he was on his way then. And very, very difficult to come round. You know, one of the fastest guys in the sprints. And I'm not just saying nationally, I'm saying in the world. So
yeah,
a good effort there from Norris, but it isn't meant to be. Jack will go through to the final, and Hayden will battle it out with the loser of the next semi-final.
Yeah, and for a little bit of context of just how fast Jack Carlin is, if you just see him cross the line there, he's pretty fresh from the Easy Velodrome in Tokyo, and that is where he set the British record 200 time of 9.306. He did qualifying earlier today in a time of 9.867, which made him the fastest qualifier. And it was actually Joe Truman who came in second, and they were the only two riders to go sub 10 today. So we knew they were fast on paper, but it's making spectacular viewing for this game of cat and mouse now. Anything, as we say, can happen in the match sprint, which is what makes it such a great one for spectators. But a lot of game playing and trying to tactically outsmart each other going on these boards, especially with teammates. You can see they're in the same kit. These guys are very, very fast, very astute, and they do a lot of training drills together.
Well, Hamish Turnbull in the inside, and the outside you have Truman. So Joe Truman will lead this one out, and he is already 1-0 up, and it was a close one. So I think Turnbull really has to turn this on its head to take it to a decider. So Truman leads the way, and Turnbull I think he'd be happy sitting in second place, trying to keep the pressure on Truman here.
And although we see riders go away, recover, regroup, and try a different tactic quite often, if you know it's working but it didn't quite pay off, you might well come back in and want to use that same tactic again. So sometimes the best plan isn't to keep changing it, which is when we've got riders of this caliber that, you know, they know what works for them, and they also know the strengths and weaknesses of their opponent. But Joe Truman, former endurance rider in his younger years, spotted with this, you know, pure power and this talent to switch into sprinting, and here he is now.
Truman will want it wound up because he'll use that. He's got long levers. And I think Turnbull will look at his opportunity to maybe take this on him from the front, maybe do what Jack Callan did, but he's not leaving the door open for him. He goes with height. He wants to try and get in front of Truman. It's not going to be here. Truman will need to lead this one out. Tries to dive inside. He has to come in early, but this is a long way around. And both side by side going round turn three, turn four, this is going to be a drag race to the finish. And he's going to do it. Turnbull takes it to a decider. Wow, he showed pure class there. I didn't think he was going to be able to do that. I thought when Turnbull starts to wind things up, he does finish it off. But it just goes to show you that end of a long day, a lot of sprinting side by side here, and it's Hamish Turnbull that turns on the power and takes it to a decider.
That was really impressive from Turnbull there.
Contest there.
Something you mentioned previously was just the fact that these riders are getting up over and over again and repeating these sorts of performances, and you can see the sheer gas it takes to get up there and fight, especially with such a close fought opponent like that. And they've repeated that a lot over the last couple of days.
Move on now. Sprinting looked good there. I think the Team Inspired riders, really impressive. They've only been off the track a few more minutes and then they're back up again. This is what I was saying before about the repechage. This is a chance to come back. But they've already done six laps of the track and, you know, put a lot out there to try and get into the semi-final. Only one can go through, so it's down to two riders now out of the next heats. So you will have two riders going through to the next stage. So two riders, two times four, two times five. It's not easy, this, when you've already been up. And you have to go again. Repechage draws just been delivered. In the first repechage, Emily Burgess, Ellie Costa, Charlotte Robinson and Lucia Steele. So they'll be on the track next. They are just drawing lots of where they will be positioned. So two will go through. So Emily Burgess, Ellie Costa, Charlotte Robinson, Lucia Steele. Two of these women will go through to the semi-final. Looking to see very quick turnaround in this one. They're all there, they're all wanting to know who they're up against, and of course they don't have a lot of time to look at who are they're up against and, you know, what their strengths, what their weaknesses.
It's a challenge, isn't it, coming back through a repechage so early on in the competition, because you can't underestimate that looking at your opponents. But I think the Kieran again is a very exciting one, because you can look on paper again at what people are likely to do, but actually it's, as I say all the time, so tactical. So it's always a really thrilling one right down to the wire, and historically we've seen so many riders come through the ranks that have just been massive entertainers. And anyone just joining us, I was saying how the heritage is a really great one when it comes to the Kieran. You look back to the sort of betting style where it originated from in Japan, and we now have the pleasure of seeing it in so many major competitions here. Just seeing the riders get the straps done up over the pedals.
Now this is fast and furious racing. For anybody that knows, this is, they have live betting out in Japan. They have schools out there. This is, you know, one of their national sports, Kieran racing. These women have already been up on the track only about 10-15 minutes ago, and this is what we're saying, it's always important if you really want to cut down in fatigue, you want to try and win your round. And for these riders, they lost out, and how much effort did they put into that first round? So
yeah, so putting that much of a fight and actually come second in qualification is a bit disheartening. But, of course, these riders are well trained to come back in all these rounds and to just fight and fight and fight. And what we often don't see is how many qualifying rounds these riders have done, or perhaps competed in other categories, other disciplines as well. And when they get to this point and we see them move towards the finals, you know, this is not where it started. It started much earlier on, with much more going through the legs to really contend with. So, we'll see these repechage rounds kick off now.
At least in Japanese Kieran racing, they have a number on their helmet. So in the inside, you have got Ellie Costa, and also the Derny driver with his red top on.
Yeah, I was going to say, everyone's in a very different, distinctive bright colour in Japan when they're betting, and they know which colour they're picking for. We've got a lot of red kits today. Team Breeze, Wales, SES.
Well, Lucia Steele is the second position inside, I've already said. On the outside in the green, Charlotte Robinson. So she'll be the rider at the back. So Emily Burgess is second from the rear, with Ellie Costa on the Derny. So Costa, Steele, Burgess and Robinson in that order. Derny will slowly wind up to 45 kilometres before dropping off the track with three laps to go. This is the last chance. Two go through, two go out. This is the last chance.
We'll see Ellie Costa there just at the front behind the Derny. And when you approach that point of 3 laps to go, when they know the Derny is going to pull off, you quite often see they go from drafting that Derny to really starting to leave a gap, to look around to see who's winding it up behind, who's going to pounce, who's going to do what. And then he will want to hold that position at the front. Some riders like to hold it, be in control, go long, and others like to mark, rush the gap and come round.
Well, Robinson trying to come round the outside there. She wants to kind of shake things up a little bit. I think Lucia Steele just, you know, biding her time in third place there, round the outside. Just easing back ever so slightly, Burgess. So it's very cagey, and you can also see that Costa has got herself kind of blocked in a little bit. But she's found herself to the front, and Lucia Steele following Costa. She realises that Costa probably the rider to beat. She accelerates down with the bell to go, drops down. Can she hold on? Costa is struggling to hold the wheel. Lucia Steele looks good here. She looks as if she's going to be, she looks behind, she just has to ease up. She is going through to the semi-final. Who is going to join her? This is going to be close behind, and it looks as if it's going to be Costa. So Lucia Steele with a breeze there, and Ellie Costa from Team Wales. We'll see them again later in the semi-final.
Lucia Steele making sure nothing was left to chance there. Look at that gap she had when she crossed the line. She didn't want to look back, didn't want to risk losing coming back through that repechage. We'd see a repeat of this again. Ellie Costa was the rider taking it on from the front, immensely hard position. Looks like she did come through for second as well. And she's a rider that's got a wealth of experience in the sprint events, a joy to watch as well.
Well, Lucia Steele was fairly close second in the first round, but you know, even looking behind, she wanted to go the whole way. She wasn't leaving anything by chance.
You know, and there's so much pressure on when essentially at the end of the day, what's at stake here is a gold medal. It's a British national championship jersey. Just seeing her across the line again and just see how sheer and how big that gap is. She certainly went and didn't look back. Ellie Costa there of Wales just crossing behind, and very close three riders behind, but yeah.
Well, unfortunately,
who's going to come through
for Burgess and Robinson, we won't see them again. So we move on to repechage 2, where we see Lauren Booth, Ellie Stone, Lowry Thomas, and Anne Whitworth Hay. So Hay will be the rider in the inside, Lauren Booth in the yellow. We have Lowry Thomas in the black. We will have Ellie Stone. So 6 laps in the track. Derny off with 3. Wind it up with 245 kilometres an hour, ever so slowly.
But over the years, we've seen really prevalent British riders, haven't we, excel on the world stage in Kieran, and a rider I obviously always liked watching was to Chris Hoy when he rode a Kira, but he just had that ability, didn't he, to go from the front, control everyone behind and just stay there. And I can't overstate just how tough it is to actually do that, and the power and control and confidence it takes.
I think with the change of the Derny and the rules and things like that, it may not have suited Chris as much, because he liked it to be wound up, and he used to fly around at the last kind of 2 laps. You never see die in this one, because you know, you only have to look at Jason Kenny in the Olympics. Just when things weren't really kind of going his own way, he took the opportunity and, you know, won yet another gold. So you don't have to be, you know, the strongest rider, but it does help, of course. But it's been in the right place at the right time, and you can see that Lowry Thomas, she wants to be in prime place. She doesn't want to leave anything by chance. Whitworth Hay pushed into second, Booth into third, Stone in fourth place. Coming up 2 laps to go, nobody wants to take this one on. We've seen this earlier, that's very difficult to take it on with 3 laps to go. Still on the front is Lowry Thomas, so Thomas wants to lead this one out.
It's immensely hard to take it on from that early on, and if you are the fastest on paper, perhaps that's potentially what you can do, but you can never make any assumptions in this discipline.
Well, Whitworth Hay tried to do what Lucia Steele done, try and grab the front, but Lowry Thomas has held the front coming down the outside. Ellie Stone of Black Line, she's going to go straight past. That's a strong ride. She was sitting in the last place, and whoa, she breezes past everybody and takes that win there. 2 to go through. That looked really easy, for the Black Rain rider, Ellie Stone, taking that one.
Ellie Stone made that look pretty effortless and actually timed that so well, didn't she? She just absolutely sprung at the right time and flew round to take that victory there.
So Ellie Stone definitely into the semi-finals together with Team Wales, Lowry Thomas, who finishes in second place there. So they'll progress. Unfortunately for Booth and Whitworth Hay, we won't see them again in this competition.
It's always good when you can manage a little smile before you cross the line, isn't it? She knew she'd got that one.
I think we were saying this about, she looked so easy there, Ellie Stone. Possibly never got it right in the first rounds, the qualifying rounds, but definitely got it right there. And this is the thing, you have to get everything right. So moving on to the next round, Elizabeth Broughton, Sports City Velo, Sylvia Mistel, Glasgow Track Racing Club, Iona Moyer, SES Racing, Serena Natt of Wales Racing Academy, Rihanna Paris-Smith of Team Terminator.
Commissaire, they're just going down the track, making sure he gets the nod off each rider that they're ready to go as the Derny then starts to wind it up and comes past for the riders to join in their drawn positions behind.
So it'll be Mistel from Glasgow will pick up the Derny, followed by Broughton in second place, and then we'll have Moyer.
We often talk about rushing the gap, don't we? It's some lingo that comes out in the commentary box a lot, and it's probably worth explaining that, especially when we're looking at the Kieran, because when a rider lays off the wheel a little bit, I mean, we're seeing her hug the Derny rear at the moment, but yeah, you see them sort of lay off a little bit, and that's to really use whatever slipstream is in front of them to actually move into that pocket and then use it to optimum acceleration benefit, because where on the road we might often want to be purely on the wheel, actually on the track it can really benefit you to just run into that gap and really use it to your advantage.
So next time round the Derny will peel off, the race will be on. Rihanna Paris-Smith in the black, just coming up round the outside. Still, Mistel in the front for Glasgow. Not really the place to be in the outside, it's the longest way around. Down the back straight. Still Mistel from Paris-Smith, coming down the outside, however. You can see that Serena Natt, she did this in the previous rounds, taking this one on. Didn't manage to hold off in the previous, but she looks good in this one, powering away down the back straights. Being chased now by Iona Moyer. And these two look as if they're going to go through to the semi-final. So Natt and Moyer make it through. Paris-Smith, Mistel and Broughton will not feature in this competition. But I'd say a good race. She tried that in the previous qualification rounds and it didn't work for her, but this time it did.
It did, and that's why we have to acknowledge that sometimes it isn't about going away and changing your game plan. Sometimes it really is. If you know you've caught yourself napping or you've made a big mistake, you want to come back and rectify that. But for the likes of Serena Natt, you know, she tried that tactic. It was a great one. Didn't quite get her straight through to the semi-final qualification. However, she knows what she needs to do. She's done it again. And I think the reason why we're seeing these gaps and these big, big efforts in qualification repechage rounds is because, you know, rider like Natt did not want to let anyone roll her back on the line. So yeah, these two riders are qualifying through now through the repechage.
Well, straight on to the final repechage, and we have Yuanda Adesida of SES Racing, Amy Cole of Wales Racing Academy, Emma Funican of Team Wales, Charlotte Sheridan of Torelli, Cayman Islands, Jodie Taylor of Team Terminator. is the Derny rider, just waits for the riders to leave the track from the previous repechage.
Team Terminator, a team I rode for many, many moons ago, run by a friend of mine, Dave Grise, who I believe you know well as well. But yeah, he's another person that's not only been a tremendous racer himself, but put a lot back into the sport.
Yeah, if you're listening, Dave, get well soon. I know he's in the hospital at the moment.
Yeah, we're thinking of you, Dave.
So it's Team Terminator, Jody Taylor, that takes the Derny. And you have Finnecat in second place, then Sheridan, Adesida, and then just at the back there, the Academy rider from Wales, Amy Cole.
Yeah, Emma Finnecan didn't have it all her way, did she? And she's coming back into the repechage with very much a view to, of course, going through. And I think it happened in the Kieran, as everybody's going to start with four laps to go, thinking about their manoeuvres, looking at each other. But yeah, fastest on paper, but let's just see how this one plays out.
Yeah, there's not a lot you can do at the moment. You just have to kind of concentrate and, you know, focus. It's really about the last three laps. The Derny will peel off now and leave it up to the riders behind, propped on the fronts from Team Terminator, Jody Taylor. As in the previous repechage, nobody wanted to take it. Adesida decides she's coming down the outside, but Finnecan, she always wants to take this one on from the front, and she is. She comes up, two laps to go. From what we've seen so far, best to be out of trouble on the front rather than take the long way around. But Taylor is in the perfect position coming down the outside. However, Amy Cole from the Wales Racing Academy. So it's going to be a battle for Wales here, with Finnecan leading the way. Cole in second place. Looking good for Wales with Finnecan and Cole. What can Team Terminator do with Jody Taylor? Can she sneak it? First two go through, and it looks as if Wales going to take it. Finnecan from Cole, so both Finnecan and Cole will go through to the semi-final. Unfortunately for Taylor, Adesida and Sheridan, it will be their event over. So another good finish for Wales there, with Team as Wales Finnecan and the Racing Academy's Amy Cole getting first and second.
Yeah, Finnecan wanting to get that automatic qualification right through to the semi-final straight off, but got second in her round, meaning that she had to come back the slightly harder way for the Kieran repechage, but that she did, and she did it convincingly. Big day of racing yesterday, as we say, backing it up, coming back to these sorts of performances.
I think our next event, as we can see the riders pensively waiting, will be our women's scratch race. Earlier on, we had two heats of 13. It's a little bit like an elimination race, where the last two riders across the finishing line wouldn't make it to the final. So we will have 22 riders in this evening's final of the scratch race. So this over 40 laps of the track. And this should be a little bit different to the qualifying, hopefully.
I really would imagine so. Two qualifying scratch races that we saw early today, the two heats that it took to whittle this field down, and we saw 11 riders qualify from each round, meaning, as Brian said, those two riders that essentially got eliminated in the style of a devil take the hindmost, for anyone that kind of knows that term for an elimination race. They got pipped to the post by the other 11 riders, and that's what's comprised our field of 22 here. The rider from Tekkers CC just leading out off the front as the bunch comes together on the rollout. 40 laps.
So once this rider, and I think this rider is no other than Nia Evans, just joins the back of the group.
Yeah, Jenny Hull leading from the front for Decker's CC as she peels off the front, rolls out at the start of this scratch.
So 40 laps, Nia Evans starting at the back, 22 riders. And I've ridden scratch races where it's gone directly from the gun and it's been full on, or it could be kind of stop start, very, very cagey. So what way do you think this is going to go?
You never, ever know. I mean, I think we can safely say that the qualification rounds will not indicate what we're going to see in the way of action tonight. We've got Nia Evans, as you mentioned, sort of rolling gently onto the back there, not expecting anyone to go straight out from the gun. But, of course, huge Olympic success from Nia Evans, fresh from another medal at the Tokyo Olympic Games in the Easy Velodrome. And it's going to be a pleasure to see her racing here today. She very convincingly, as expected, fastest on paper, made it through her qualification race in the lead with a very big gap behind her. But we've got a lot of talent in this scratch race, just seeing the riders of Cairns Basso racing in positions 2, 3 and 4 there coming through to the front.
Yeah, they do have numbers. It's clear to be seen this is an individual championship, however, but they do have numbers, and I think they'll need those numbers. But the last thing you really want to do is, when you pull off from the front, is, you know, go too far back in this bunch, because anything can happen at any time, and the last thing you want to do is be closing gaps. You know, you play the waiting game and, you know, save it for the sprint. But from what we've seen, you know, that's going to fit in with Nia Evans and her game plan. You know, she looks so strong. She's just coming through to the front now, just a very short turn, and she'll move up and, you know, allow other riders to come through. But yeah, she's got the most experience, although she's not been, you know, in cycling all her life. Over the last few years, however, she has done tremendously well. But, you know, are we going to see someone trying to kind of try and gain that lap, trying to attack?
I really think we will. And again, I think that's because, you know, these riders don't just come into this not thinking about what might play out. They're going to look down that list, know exactly what their competitors are likely to do. You know, a lot of these riders know each other very well, and everybody will have that name scribbled down ahead of this Nia Evans because of, you know, literally her track record. And you're going to want to do everything you can to not perhaps allow it to just come down to a pure bunch sprint at the end of it. And going back to what you were saying, the size of this bunch, if you let any gaps form and you drift towards the back, it can be game over, and you can let somebody go, and that's when laps start to be gained and things start to splinter. So even for the best riders in the world, positioning is so, so key, and moving yourself back up where possible, sensing the danger, knowing where it's lulling and where you can take an opportunity. But yeah, I've got absolutely no doubt we'll see some big attacks, because a scratch race, you know, simply on paper, put it's the first person across the line that wins, second and third, that's our podium positions. But people are going to want to try to do whatever they can to make sure that it's not just an obvious order of the day.
Well, 10 laps in and we haven't seen any attacks yet. I'll just run through quickly who's in this race. Ella Barnwell of Cairns Basso, Charlotte Broughton, Al O'Shea, Katie Ann Carlton, Liv CC, Nia Evans, Team Hoop, Francesca Hall, Loughborough, Georgina Hillard of Team Boom Pods, Jenny Hall, Tickers, Kinga Ingram, Story Racing, Ellie Jamieson of Liv CC, Amber Junker of VC Launderers, Sophie Langford of Alba Development, Maddie Leach, Cams Basso, Sophie Lewis, Cams Basso, Grace Lister of Brother UK, Anna Morris of Team Wales, Flora Perkins of Lacol Wahoo, Holly Ramsey of Brother UK, Lowry Richard of Backstead Bike Performance, Kate Richardson of Alba, Alwyn Roberts of Liv CC, Eilid Shaw of Tufati, and Libby Smithson of Awol. So that is the list of competitors here. And, you know, from Tekkers at the front there, and is Jenny Hall. So this, so far to me, no attacks, 14 laps in. We were looking for maybe a bit more of an animated race, but everybody's just willing to take their turn at the front and possibly wait for the last 10 laps here.
Yeah, I think we saw Sophie Lankford come through there again. She had a really good start to the Nationals yesterday. And Alba Development Team is one of the teams we'll look out for in here. They're a new team this year. We've got the colours of Cam's Basso Racing, which is the red sleeves, the yellow. I think I'm right in saying that Charlotte Broughton is in an all-black skin suit, so one to look out for there as well, as we see the first attack of the day.
Yep, we do. And you know, a big acceleration now from Charlotte Broughton of Awol as she accelerates, closed down by Cam's Basso. And you know, this is starting to stretch things out ever so slightly now.
And that's what it's doing, it's stretching it out, and we start to see those gaps we talked about forming. And you just saw a rider there when sensed that danger, that gap, and she did a very short turn and peeled off. But if you have too many people doing that, not wanting to chase that gap down, that's when you can get into danger further back. But we are seeing it all come back together. But every time you have to go across that gap to chase it down, it just saps a little bit of that energy.
Well, you can see that Nia Evans, she's sitting, you know, close to the back of this field. She's playing the waiting game. You know, she knows that she's one of the fastest coming to finish, probably one of the strongest in the field. But I think we saw the first attack, but it needs to be constant attacks. We're almost halfway through this event. 40 laps this time round. We'll see 20 to go. We've only seen one attack. The riders from Alba Development on the front there. But the roll up the track, and again it slows down ever so slightly.
I think the other element with a rider like Nia Evans is knowing when it's dangerous and when you need to chase and when you need to expend that energy. And talking of which, she's on the front now in the colours of Hoove, which is the red at the top fading into black. But yeah, she'll know when to sense the danger, because she's just got such you know, a huge, vast level of experience in bunch racing. So you don't want to be chasing absolutely everything, but as you say, don't want to be caught too far back.
She's actually doing the longer turns. She's done about half a lap in the front. Everybody's doing kind of short turns, rolling up the banking. But now Cam's Basso putting the pressure on. And they do have numbers, three riders in this race. And, you know, with numbers, I know an individual championship, but you can, you know, deliver the performance. And Team Wales also up there, Anna Morris swings up, everybody just doing short turns, gaps appearing a little bit now. The riders from Alba again towards the front in the blue, but Cam's pushing on at the bottom of the track, a reaction now, look behind, and now we're starting to see some gaps opening at the front with 16 laps to go.
Yeah, we saw Maddie Leach and Sophie Lewis pulling through on the front, really looking to animate this race. And the blue squad that you can spot is Alba Racing. Some big talent in there, including the likes of Sophie Lankford. Kate Richardson, teammate of Sophie Lankford, also Alba Development. And yeah, she had a stunning day in the saddle yesterday, producing more and more and more PBs. But we are seeing this race start to hot up, seeing some splinters towards the back as well.
Well, that was Kate Richardson on the attack, and I think that's a rider, and I think we mentioned it earlier on, you do not want to go down or gain any time down the track purely because she has got, you know, good pursuiting credentials. So the four riders that were distanced there have now been brought back.
Yeah, they're back on. And when you see a lull like this, this is when a lot of people will be thinking, is this the time to go? So Kate Richardson coming through again. Not at Broughton.
This looks as if this has got final sprints written all over it. I don't think there's enough time for anybody to gain any time. Nia Evans comes through again, and she'll do a longer turn. She's done this all the way through. The closer we get to the final laps, the better it is for her. Everybody has to think about this and try and make it as hard as possible, try and go on the attack. But Nia Evans does a half lap on the front, swings over, and no attack still. We've seen one, two accelerations, but now 10 laps to go, still all together.
It is, and as you say, Nia Evans wants it to play into her hands and stay in control of this. And it is about choosing your time to go, because you've got to realise at this point in the race, you know, you've got a limited amount of time in a race of this distance to go and take the lap, and you want to take that lap as efficiently, if you can, and as quickly as you possibly can as well.
Yeah, you can see Flora Perkins coming to the front from Lecole. Wahoo in the bottom of the track. Again, it's Anna Morris of Team Wales.
Yeah, with nine laps to go, that window is closed for lap gains. But now everyone looking at each other and very likely to come in as a bunch gallop.
Just looking at Sophie Langford there for the Alba team. She has been at the front a lot now. That's the rider in the blue. She hasn't been pushing on, she hasn't been attacking, but she's been riding a lot towards the front of this event.
Yeah, just policing it a little bit at the front, keeping an eye, never, if you'll notice, letting herself drift too far back, and that's the position that she's been keeping her in with her experience.
Nia Evans again coming to the front. She disappears, she comes back to the front, and I think from now on to the finish of this event, you want to stay as close to the front as possible. It's the only person that's doing longer turns. Everybody, basically Londres, Amber Junker, who's in second place, just follows Nia Evans up the track. At the bottom there, you have Libby Smithson on the front. Have we seen an attack at the bottom of the track?
Maddie Leach going for Cam's Basso, leading at the front. Knows she's got to do something. Five laps to go now, but dragging that field with her.
Yeah, you can see a small gap starting to open now. A bit more pressure on the front of the race. Gaps starting to appear. Still shorter turns, getting closer and closer to this final kilometre. You get Flora Perkins pushing on. She pushes up the track.
And that's what the riders are
doing. The last kilometre of this race, and it's still cagey. Nobody wanting to leave this one out. It is going to come down to that sprint. A late attack again here at the bottom of the track. Richardson trying to close this one down, so this is a danger now, but Nia Evans comes over the top, and you know, this is a push for glory now, but Nia Evans has got her in her sights and is pulling her back. With two laps to go, this is going to wind up. Nia Evans in the perfect place. Sophie Lewis, Cam's Basso is there following up. So Nia Evans is coming up with two Cam's Basso riders on her wheel. So Nia Evans, she's still got a lot to do. Coming over the top of the Cam's Basso, and you've got Ella Barnwell. She's surpassed, she's over the top, but just look at the fight of Nia Evans. Nia Evans on the inside, this is going to be a close one, and it is. It's Ella Barnwell of Cam's Basso taking it. She beats Nia Evans. She is the new scratch race champion of Britain. What an effort that was. Just when I thought that Nia Evans was going to take this one out, fantastic result. Ella Barnwell, they had numbers there, just coming over the top, and just over Anna Morris of Wales coming down, and it was a three-horse race coming down. And the inside, you'd Nia Evans the favourite, Ella Barnwell in the middle, and Morris, and it looks as if Morris takes silver and Nia Evans is pushed down into the bronze medal position. Fantastic result for Cam's Basso. Ella Barnwell, your new champion.
Look at that for a finish. Can just see the position, each of those three riders trying a final lunge to the line. Ella Barnwell from Cam's Basso, what a tremendous ride she's just put in. We thought we might see somebody try and go for a lap, some really early moves, but we didn't. It all came down to a sprint. The favourite on paper was always going to be Nia Evans going in, but actually, what a close finale. It looked like Nia Evans took third there, Anna Morris in second for Team Wales, and Ella Barnwell taking the victory. And that was an exhausting effort, but she will be very elated.
Well, another Welsh win. She isn't in the national colours, but she is from Wales. So Ella Barnwell taking a fantastic result. They had three riders in there, and it was in fact Sophie Lewis that was up there towards the end. Nia Evans tried to take that one, tried so hard, but in the end she was beaten outright by Barnwell coming around the last corner now. And Nia Evans was in the best place, just didn't have the legs. And Ella Barno comes over the top, and Morris, she had to go the long way around. Unfortunately for Jenny Hall, she has taken fourth for Tekkis. But it's all about the win. Another win for Wales, and a nice win for Cams Basso in Ella Barno.
Certainly was. It looked to me like it was Francesca Hall in the black skin suit for Loughborough that went for an early move and really took it on in the way that, you know, she did everything she could. But, you know, that final sprint inevitably happened, and what a finale, what a close fought battle.
A well-earned rest, a well-earned seat. Well done, Ella Barnwell. So Ella Barnwell takes the gold, Anna Morris silver, Jenny Hall, or is it Jenny? St. Jenny Hall there took third. I'm sure it was Nia Evans. It's just been
yeah, I think we've just had
corrected.
It corrected.
So yeah, Nia Evans takes the third place. So women's scratch final. All came down to a sprint finish after 40 laps of the track. And the next event will be the... we'll go sprinting again, where we will see the bronze medal ride off between Turnbull and Norris. So this is the best of three again. And up on the track is Norris in the green for Team Inspired. Followed by Turnbull. Exactly the same equipment, apart from Norris, equipped with a moustache.
A moustache helps us, doesn't it, when everyone's in identical kit on the same bike?
Exactly, exactly identical. Not too much between the difference of the riders. So it's Turnbull at the front. And Norris at the rear. This is the first leg, or the first match, best of three. So Turnbull so far, he prefers to take things on from the front. As you said, Rebecca, former endurance rider, now comes sprinter. Again. They play around. Norris was trying to keep some height. He wants to keep some height. Tries to go to the inside. That's blocked. Turnbull wants to keep prime position. Norris goes high. He dives down and he is on the wheel. Not a lot of rush room. So Norris has a lot to do and he gives up straight away. He knew he made fractions of a mistake there and it wasn't meant to be. It's one of these things where you know what you want to try, but unfortunately for Norris there, Turnbull had the better of him, and he knew when he went into the bank in there that he didn't have the legs to come round Turnbull. So Turnbull goes 1-0 up, and Norris, if he wants that bronze medal, will have to take it to a decider.
Yeah, you could just see that body language. He just knew then, didn't he? But this is a best of three. That was match one. We'll have a second one. They'll regroup, they'll recover, they'll get on the rollers and they'll come back, and then it could come down to a decider. It's the joy of the match sprint, that it can go through to a third round.
So we move on to the gold medal ride, gold and silver. Jack Callan up with Jason Kenny as his hold up man.
Not a bad hold up man to have, is it?
Yeah, good man to be by your side. Joe Truman.
But it is important, isn't it, Brian, to have this wealth of talent coming into the coaching staff. This is going to be a very exciting match sprint indeed this evening at the Geraint Thomas Velodrome. As that whistle goes, riders start to look at each other. Teammates here, of course, in the same kit.
Well, I think Truman is nothing to lose. He's, both of them are going to get a medal. You know, who's going to be champion? You know, he's now propped on the front and he'll give it absolutely everything to try and beat Callan. He knows what Callan is going to do. He knows his strength, he knows his weaknesses, they all do. So you could clearly see that in the previous round Norris knew that he wasn't going to get round, so why go and push when he knows that the next leg he might need that to better him. So I think it's a good call from Norris. He knew he didn't want to go too deep and maybe save it and try and put it to a decider, but for Truman I think he knows what he's up against. He's up against the fastest of qualifiers. How can he outsmart him? Jack Callan is pushing, and Truman, I think for me, he wants to ride this one from the front. He does not want Jack to pass him. So he's winding it up. Jack tries to dive down the outside. Nope, goes up with a lot of speed. Truman keeps him high. Jack looks at the door. He gets through the door on the inside. Bang. Easy as that. Split second decision. Truman gives up. He knows he's beaten. That's what he was trying to stop. Truman was trying to stop, close the door, he wasn't able to do that, and in great fashion Jack Callan goes 1-0 up. So he has got one hand in that jersey at the moment and looks good to become the next champion. But as we say it in cycling, never say never, and Joe Truman has to learn from that. It was craft in the end from Jack Callan. He tried once, he tried again. You watch it here, he's watching. I think Truman doesn't come down quick enough. Jack is in there, and of course once Jack is in there, Truman can't come in. He can't come into that red sprinter's line. So that was it. Perfect tactics from Jack Callan, unfortunately for Truman.
It was, and the track craft, as you say, craft really is the word for it. The commitment from Carlin to that move, because you can't not commit when you're going for such a big plunge. And actually, yeah, that moment of hesitation, and that is it. It was all to play into Jack Carlin's hands, but not over yet. We've got plenty more entertainment to go up in the way of the match sprint. Best of three could still go to a decider.
Denny man's out again.
Working him hard.
Now the only non-red outfit in this semi-final is Black Line, Lauren Bell. So thank you, Lauren.
Thank you, Lauren Bell.
Easily spotted. You have got two from Team Wales. Two from the Wales Racing Academy and Iona Moyer of SES Racing. So Lauren Bell, Ellie Costa, Emma Finnegan, Stephanie Hall, Iona Moyer and Serena Natt. So first, second and third go through to the gold medal right. Fourth, fifth and sixth will go to the minor final. So really you want to be in the top three here. So where they draw, they are placed behind the derby. No fighting for that spot these days.
I do kind of miss the fight a little bit.
I like
is that bad of me?
I like your face.
We used to see so much jostling in the Kieran behind the Derny that we'd get, you know, elbows, shoulders out, hips out. right, just slipped from position. But now those riders have been drawn in a particular order, and they must stay there in this competition.
So it's Iona Moyer of SAS Racing at the front, followed by Lauren Bell. And then we have Finnegan, followed by Costa, with the two Wales Racing Academy riders, Nat and Paul, towards the back. The difference between Team Wales and the Academy is the white stripe down the back.
And there's a lot of talent in there over this weekend, isn't there, Brian? And I think for me, you know, I was massively inspired by the likes of Vicky Pendleton in the Kieran. And I think, you know, there's been so many people wanting to emulate that level of success since in the UK. And yeah, we're seeing so much young talent come through.
So Moya propped on the front. Now we see an acceleration. This looks like it's Stephanie Hall that is accelerating into the front. Lauren Bell astute to this one. She doesn't want to go now. She's trying to position herself over the top. Of course, calls Emma Finnegan. Finnegan leading this one on from the front. Oh, a bit of a reaction there. But Finnegan taking this one on from the front, and it looks as if she is going to take this one. But we're looking at the top three now, and they'll know this. The top three will go right through to the final, and it looks as if it's going to be Finnegan taking it. We know that Lauren Bell is through in this one, so I think it was Ellie Costa that was up there. So just waiting for confirmation on that, but it did look good for Finnegan taking that one.
Yeah, Finnegan.
Stephanie Hall and Lauren Bell are the top three. So unfortunately for Iona Moyer, Ellie Costa and Serena Natt, they will go into the battle for the minor places. And you can see that Finnegan coming down the outside with the acceleration. Stephanie Hall opts into second place. It looked as if Stephanie Hall had a bit of a problem there with about a lap to go. But safely through anyway, Finnegan, Hall and Bell, with the other three, they'll go into the minor final. So some more red jerseys for you to conjure with. Easy for me to say, conjure with. So Emma Finnegan, Stephanie Hall, Lauren Bell will go through to the final.
The sheer pace, isn't it, of these events mixed in with very similar looking kits, at times identical kits. But yeah, brilliant to see the Kieran tonight, Saturday night here at the Geraint Thomas Velodrome, and so brilliant to see pack stands again after not having any national championships held at all last year due to COVID postponements. Of course, so many things put on hold, but there's a really nice buzz in here this evening, and but these riders, a lot of them haven't pinned a number on until this weekend for quite some time, and it's been a lot of lonely lockdown training. It's been a real psychological challenge for so many people, having to keep their training plan without being able to get, you know, even near their training grounds, let alone a racetrack, and getting that number on the back. So yeah, it's been a really exciting edition of the championships.
So thank you, Ellie Stone. She is the rider in the black at the top of the track. And we'll pick out the other riders. Two with white helmets, two with black. So two with white helmets are from Team Breeze. And then we get one from Team Wales and one from the Wales Racing Academy. Rhian Edmonds, I think, is the one to watch out in this one. She's in fantastic form after winning the sprint competition last night and cruising through in her heat straight into this semi-final.
Yeah, and not only is there immense talent within the Team Breeze at this level, the team set up for the GB Academy riders, but it puts back so much into the sport. It's still operating very much so at grassroots level. Breeze rides, getting more competitors in. Not only that, getting people for the love of bike riding into the sport. So can't thank Breeze enough for their network.
Yes, Amy Cole on the down it. Giving some room is Laurie Thomas. She doesn't want to be caught out. Some gaps starting to appear. First three. As long as you're in the first three, you'll go into the final for gold, silver and bronze. So a little bit more cagey this one. Nobody's trying to steal a march as we say that. We get Ellie Stone coming round the outside. Laurie Thomas wants to take this on one on. Two laps to go. Team Breeze sitting down towards the back with Sophie Capewell. Still Thomas. Looks like Capewell is starting to come down the outside now. The acceleration is coming. And this is a big effort from Team Breeze taking this one on.
Expecting a big move from Sophie Capewell. She didn't get the colour of medal she wanted yesterday. She's come back fighting in this, Kieran.
Yeah, she definitely has. Sophie Capewell taking this one on from the front, so it's going to be strong right there from Capewell. Looked as if Thomas also sneaks in there in the top three. We'll just wait for confirmation on that. So it looked like we have our three riders through with Capewell, Rhian Edmonds and Ellie Stone. So Ellie Stone going through for a black line. That might be, you know, a different jersey in the final as well. All red jerseys apart. So Sophie Capewell, Rhian Edmonds, Ellie Stone will go through to the final. Laurie Thomas, Lucia Steele and Amy Cole will go through to the minor final.
I'm really excited now for that final. What a talent pool we're going to have in there.
Yeah, it gets better and better as this competition gets on there. But yeah, Sophie Capewell just decided she moved up at the right time, used her experience and, you know, delivered a good win there. But it's not about the win, it's just making sure she gets into the final and she gets a chance to ride for gold.
Certainly is, and a young rider, but one with so many years of experience under her belt already. And she rode phenomenally yesterday, but I know she would have been disappointed to not go home with the national stripes on her shoulders. So she's going to fight every step of the way of this, Kieran, and just make sure she does absolutely everything she can to first of all make it through to that final and then keep that battle going.
Like now we are moving on to the men's points race. We had three heats earlier on today. And we have quite a few qualifiers to go through. Some of them still warming up. Do you like a points race?
I love a points race. Just getting a glimpse of it. I thought the riders were having a hug there, but I think he's just sorting out his skin suit for him. But yeah, I absolutely love a points race. I mean, I am in appreciation that I've pretty much said that about every track discipline over the last 2 days. And I promise that's not being fickle. I just can't get enough of track racing, and I'm very, very excited that it's back. But I love a bunch race, and there's so many races within the race, of course. So much to keep an eye on when you're looking at the points, and we're glimpsing a shot of John Archibald in the black skin suit there, all smiles before this points race final.
I'll just go through who's in the men's points race, and this will be 120 laps. There will be sprints.
There will be.
There are double points on the finish. There could be some lap gains. So John Archibald, PC member, Harry Burchill, Team Inspired, Ross Burrell, Team Inspired, Jack Bruff, Team Inspired, Matty Dobbins, RT23, Matt Gibson with Sun God, Josh Giddings, Team Inspired, Michael Gill, St. Pirin, Kyle Gordon, Spellman, George Gray, Zappy Jr. Racing Team, Joe Holtz, a local man from Wales, from Clanelli. previous under 23 team pursuit champion, Callum Moyer from Zappy Jr.'s racing team, Oscar Nielsen Julian from Team Inspired, Tomos Patterson from Hale Zone, Will Perrott from Spellman, Cameron Richardson from RT23, Owen Roberts from Wales Racing Academy. We've got Will Roberts from Team Wales, again from West Wales, 22-year-old in the Nationals in 2020. He got silver in the points race, so watch out for him. Jack Rutten Gray, Team Inspired, Charlie Tanfield, Ribble Welltight, Joshua Tarling, Flanders Colour, Will Tidball, Team Inspired, Callum Twelves, Team Oton Avis, and Ben Wiggins, Fensham House. 24 riders in this field, so we are expecting some thrills and spills.
Hopefully not the spills. We saw a crash earlier in the third heat of qualifying. It's never what we want to see. It happened very close to the final lap in the final kilometre, and we're very much hoping everybody's recovered well from that.
So the riders already warmed up. Quite a lot of the academy riders in this one. They will be riding the green kits.
The qualification races, you roll out one lap, you get a whistle, second time through, you'll get the gun. 120 laps, sprints will be 10 as usual, double on the end. You ready to go, Patrick?
So you just heard that from the commissar. Rolling round, they will get the gun, 120 laps, sprints. Every 10 laps, 5, 3, 2 and 1. They've already had 3 heats and these are the cream of the crop. So all 24 riders starting. How good are your maths?
My maths? I think I put the pen down from A-level maths and said never again. So I bet you're delighted I'm next to you in the booth tonight.
I've got a Scottish higher in maths, so... So the gun goes, we start, and already an acceleration at the front of the group.
This is what we thought that we might see in the women's scratch race earlier, but a very, very early move there in this men's points race final, 119 laps ahead.
Yeah, we got a chaser as well. So two riders, and as the bunch come into life now, they will start to roll around the bottom of the track. Six green jerseys in here for Team Inspired, so I would expect that, you know, they don't want this early action, but it's nice to see you come into this race, you qualify for the race, and you know what you want from this is, you know, trying to surprise, and you know when you go on the attack, as soon as you see the riders going from the off, it's you know really nice to see. It's Josh Tarling in the pink, you know, a very good up and coming rider that's decided to try and go on the attack and maybe surprise, try and kind of take that lap. But I think the peloton are now up to speed now and don't want that to happen.
Yeah, and it looks like these riders come into it knowing exactly what he was going to do straight away. I mean, to go that early from the gun, you've got to have a game plan. We talked about it in the women's bunch race earlier, is that if you're going to go for laps, especially in a points race, you want to do it as quickly and as efficiently as possible, not be getting to the latter stages of the race and thinking, oh, I've still got time to go for it. You've got to absolutely commit, as easy as it is for me to say that, and not let yourself dangle. So to make that commitment very early on, yeah, he really wanted to go for that move decisively.
Well, it was Cameron Richardson that initially went on the attack for RT23, the rider in the black. In the pinky coloured blue is the young talent Josh Talling of Flanders, and you know, he decided to join them. They do have almost half a lap, and it's now three laps to the first sprint, so two leaders. The peloton or the bunch behind are everybody's doing, you know, fairly short turns. They don't want these two riders to gain this lap, so still just under half a lap to Cameron Richardson and Josh Tarling. It does look as if, coming up to one lap to go to the first sprint of the day, that these two riders in front of Richardson and Tarling will be taking the 5 and the 3. So first four places, 5, 3, 2 and 1 in the sprints every 10 laps. So sometimes riders will take them early, sometimes they'll wait a little bit. It's not worth going for every sprint, and it looks like it's Tarling. It takes that one across the line.
Yeah, the riders out the front will take those points, but the race is very much on behind. As much as I said, these riders want to gain the lap, they don't want to let themselves dangle out there. Well, the riders behind have something to say about that. 5 points for Josh Tarling.
So the points in that sprint were Josh Tarling.
So Josh Tarling, Cameron Richardson, Will Tibdall and Will Perrott there. As you order across the line with those two riders out ahead.
So they still continue with their effort as expected. No lull in the action behind. Team Inspired still towards the front in the green. They will want to try and take this title, but both Cameron Richardson and Josh Tarling spending the first 14 laps off the front of the bunch. They still have just almost a quarter of a lap. John Archibald comes to the front of the peloton. Plenty of green jerseys in there. A lot of riders just sitting towards the back and possibly biding their time there to maybe try and go on the attack, try and take that lap. But this gap coming down ever so slowly now. Cameron Richardson and Josh Tarling swapping well at the front, but this gap down to about 100, 150 metres now.
Yeah, that gap looks to be coming down now. Obviously, those two riders out front looking to take the lap. That was Josh Tarling and Cameron Richardson, who took 5 and 3 points respectively, followed with the bunch led by Will Tibdall and Will Perrott.
Sometimes an early attack does manage to get an early lap, which forces the hand of others. But, you know, it's a bold move by both Richardson and Tarling, but it does look as if the bunch behind are getting closer and closer. And we are down to two laps to the next sprint. It's Richardson that decides that he cannot stay with Tarling. Tarling wanted to take the 5 points. Next time round, we will hear the bell. Josh Tarling still in front. He is now being chased by Will Perrott. And can Will Perrott come to terms with Josh Tarling? I think this is going to be a close one. Coming up the finishing straight now, and Perrott comes over the top. So Perrott takes the 5 points there. Josh Tarling takes the 3 points. Team Inspired then coming across the line in third and fourth. And this is starting to split up now. I tell you what, Josh Tarling is on a mission here, and it's going to be a really strung out race now, because Team Inspired are firing two riders across this gap.
Really is. So just confirmation of that sprint across the line, and Joshua Tarling, that run over the top, has got 8 points now, followed by Will Perrott, who's got 6. Cameron Richardson sits with 3 points, and Oscar Nielsen-Julian has 2 points there. Will Tibdall, 2 points as well. Getting excited here in the commentary box. And we've got Jack Reed-Gray with 1 point behind.
Yeah, just as Nelson Julian and Richardson, you know, come across to the Perrott and Tarling in front, it looks as if Team Inspired bringing it all back together. So, you know, that was a fast few laps now. Good effort from Josh Tarling there in the pink and the blue, but Team Inspired firing a couple of riders across there with Julian Nielsen and Richardson. Perrott did enough there to take the 5 points, so not much in it, but Josh Tarling at the top of the leaderboard with 8 points to Perrott's six. But it's constant action now from the team in green. They now have three riders at the front of the peloton, sending a fourth one, but they dive up the banking, and then this is getting faster and faster.
Certainly is. The green colours of Team Inspired, plenty of green splattered at the head of the action here throughout this bunch. And yeah, I mean, we've certainly not been short of any action here. The injections of pace, the attacks just keep coming thick and fast. Currently Josh Tarlin leading in the front with 8 points.
Yes, Lord. Ever so slightly now. Josh Talley still getting involved in the mix. He is full of beans at the moment in the black. He did spot John Archibald in third place. Leading for Team Inspired is Oscar Nielsen Juliet, as the pace slows ever so slightly. A couple of riders have been dropped from the back of the peloton coming up to the bell lap. And now we're starting to see Charlie Tanfield, who set the second fastest time in the pursuit. Josh Tarling still in second place here. Charlie Tanfield coming up, looks as if he's going to take five. Tarling, and then John Archibald. So a little bit of a split. Nisa, this is a danger. No, four strong riders going off the front.
That is a very dangerous quartet looking. To allow to get off the front there. We know what Charlie Tanfield can do against the clock. We saw it yesterday, taking second, a silver medal in the pursuit against the clock. And we've got an update on those points now. Josh Tarling sitting with 11 points, Will Perrott with six, and Charlie Tanfield in five, with five. John Archibald picking up 2 points there.
And it was Josh Giddings that took the other points there. But it's all come back together, and as expected, that was a danger quartet. You couldn't let them go down, especially the form that Charlie Tanfield is on at the moment.
No, you really don't want to let any Tanfield go. We've got eight riders with points now, and no laps gained so far.
So Tanfield at the front, followed by three riders from Team Inspired. It's an attack from Team Inspired down the back straight. Josh Tarling is on a ride today. He comes to the front. He's got Team Inspired rider in front of him, and this is the Oscar Nielsen Juliet. He's been an early animator.
Yep, Oscar Nielsen Julian with 2 points currently is the rider in the green that's gone off the front. 85 laps to go.
Yeah, so Nielsen Julian still has a bit of a gap here. Almost a quarter of a lap. Very difficult when you're on your own to do this. Very difficult to take a lap. It can take so much out you, and you know, you really suffer for it later on. So 83 laps to go in this race.
I was just thinking that he'll want some company, but you've got to take your opportunity, you've got to commit to it, you can't look around too much, and as I say, when you're going to go for that lap, you've got to try and do it as quickly as possible. And behind him, you keep seeing riders pull off, ease up the pace, but there's plenty of people in this bunch that don't want to allow that to happen.
Yeah, and that was Jack Brough from Team Aspard, now firing off the front, trying to join his teammates of Nielsen Julian. Bell, so points with 80 laps to go. Josh Tarling still in there chasing points. The 5 points are going to go to Nielsen Julian. Tarling's coming round, but over the top of Tarling. So Tarling's going to take some points, but that was Will Roberts taking his first points of this points race today. 80 laps to go now.
just waiting for confirmation of what that has done to the overall point standings. And Josh Tarlin still leads the way with 13 points, followed by Oscar Nielsen Julian with 7. Will Parrott now holds 6 points. Charlie Turnfield in 5 points. Will Roberts 3. John Archibald 2. And Will Tidball as 2 as well. We've got 3 riders behind with 1 point, including now Joe Holt and Jack Rootkin Gray and Josh Giddings. Josh Giddings, too excited to speak, Brian.
Yes, slowed ever so slightly after that sprint. There will be 77 laps to go, this 120 lap points race. Josh Tarling leading this one with 13 points. His next challenger has got 7 points. So they still roll round. Nobody has gained a lap as yet. Often laps are gained later in the event when riders start to get tired. Jack Bruff just swings up. And now we see an attack again from John Archibald.
No surprises to see an attack from John Archibald.
Exactly. So John Archibald, he wants to try and gain this lap. He's been joined by Will Roberts. And that's a formidable duo. Will Roberts, we said beforehand, he was silver in this competition in 2020. So maybe John Archibald maybe hasn't had the track time, but he's used it over the last kind of couple of days. And, you know, we're going to see a reaction here. George Gray from Zappi came to the front. Now we get 3 riders, 4 riders now from Team Inspire, but it's Will Roberts and John Archibald.
Yeah, John Archibald hadn't had a huge amount of track time. In fact, not a huge amount. He hadn't really had any track time coming into this national championships, and we saw him out there yesterday. And he's gone on the attack. And then to look round and see the calibre of Will Roberts behind you, well, you'd be very happy for that company, I think.
Well, on the attack now is Michael Gill, St. Pirren. He realises the big danger here. There was a slight lull. Josh Tarling still in the front. So a lap to go to the next sprint with 70 to go, and Archibald and Roberts will take the 5 and 3. Josh Tarling again towards the front. He wants as many points as possible. He accelerates down the back. So Archibald taking 5 and Roberts the 3. Josh Tarling, wow, taking the 2 points. Will Parrott the 2 points, and this is starting to split up now. It's in. We've got 2 riders in front, another 5 riders, another 6 riders, another 6 riders. It's taking its toll now.
It certainly is, and when you want to take that lap is, as you say, when people are tiring, when people are getting ragged. But this race is on. No one's wanting to let anything go, especially John Archibald. And he's joined by Will Roberts out the front at the moment, but they are chasing down. The confirmation of where the points sit now, it's Josh Tarling in the lead with 15 points. John Archibald follows with 7. Oscar Nielsen Julian also has 7 alongside Will Parrott. Will Roberts, who's been out front with John Archibald, currently has 6. Charlie Townfield 5.
Well, it looks as if it's all over for John Archibald and Will Roberts, as the bunch behind, not the whole bunch, are bringing it all back together. Just as I say that, we get another attack. This looks like it's Charlie Tanfield that's now deciding to go. So Charlie Tanfield, Will Parrott chasing with Nielsen Julian. So they know that they cannot let Tanfield go. Not in the form he's got. You don't do a 4-7 and a 4-8 in the Pursuit Championship. So yeah. Charlie Tanfield is a marked man. He's already got about 20 metres, and Will Parrott is trying to join him.
And we must remember that the British record set by John Archibald that we came into yesterday's pursuit rounds with actually was smashed twice, once by Charlie Tanfield and then by Dan Bigham. So you don't want to let Charlie Tanfield go out alone. And these guys certainly know how to efficiently get ahead, and that's what he's doing at the moment. But no one wants to let that happen. Let's see. Looks like a little bit of a lull in the bunch with some of the team-inspired riders peeling up there.
I don't think there'll be a choice, Rebecca. Charlie Tanfield is already half a lap up. Will Parrott cannot get onto terms with him. He is about 20 metres behind. Now we see an attack from the front from Jack Bruff, but it does look as if Charlie Tanfield, he keeps this up. He's got the crowd behind him, could be taking this lap. Will Parrott still about 20 metres behind him. Then comes Jack Brough from Team Inspired, John Archibald, and Charlie Tanfield is coming. He's almost in the same straights. He will take the maximum points on this next sprint with half this race gone, but Will Perrott cannot get on. These two are doing it individually.
Just look at the sheer pace of Charlie Tanfield, and if he can get the back of that bunch in sight, that's what he needs.
We've just seen a crash as well. Two riders coming down. One of the Team Inspired riders, it looks like. No, it isn't. One of the Welsh riders. But just watching here, and Charlie Tanfield has taken the maximum point. Will Perry is still in. Riders all over the track. But Charlie Tanfield still. He goes down the back straight and just into turn four. You can see the front of the peloton. You also have Will Perrott in here. Team Inspired now firing another rider across here. They had Jack Brough, but this is spread all over the track. Still Charlie Tanfield. He is eking closer and closer to the back of that peloton. A reaction from Will Tidbolt from Team Inspired. Josh Tallon doing a fantastic ride. He's staying up there.
He is, and Charlie Tanfield.
We're just looking at this crash, sorry Rebecca, at the peloton. It happened near the back of this peloton. Yeah. I think it was one of the Welsh riders, could be Joe Holt that has come down. We'll wait for confirmation on that, but I'm just watching Tanfield. He is getting closer and closer.
He certainly is, and with that margin gained, he's just got to keep that focus, which he knows how to do so well. He has to keep them in sight and just keep going for that lap. Now he's gained so much, but the points he took as first across the line have taken him currently up to third in the points tally. He has 10, Will Perrott has 10, and in the lead currently on points is Josh Tarling with 15.
Well, Will Perrott has been joined by Nelson Julian, but they aren't closing the gap in Charlie Tanfield. Charlie Tanfield is only about 10 metres off the back. He is going to gain this lap on the field. So Charlie Tanfield coming up with 53 laps to go. Just about to make contact, only has to overlap the back wheel, and Charlie Tanfield has taken 20 points. He's taken this lap, but behind Nelson Julian and Will Perrott, and still in no man's land. They are half a lap down from taking this lap. Can they do it? So the numbers on the board, I would say that Charlie Tanfield goes straight to the top.
Well, by taking that lap, absolutely right. It takes Charlie Tanfield to the top there, 30 points, putting Josh Tarling into second on 15, as he hasn't gained the lap, and Will Perrott at 10. But this race is on, and Charlie Tanfield, textbook on how to take a lap. He got the bunch in his sights, and he's just made that catch. And you just hear the roar here in the velodrome when he successfully did that and made contact.
We get another move off the front, and this is Ben Wiggins trying to do something about this. He's been very quiet. He was, of course, involved in the crash earlier on today, but still half a lap from gaining a lap. Will Perrott. Will Perrott tried to go with Charlie Tanfield, but he wasn't able to make it. He has Nelson Julian with him. They are trying to gain this lap, but still a high tempo in this race. Riders going into the last 50 laps will start to fatigue. But this is a big, big effort from Will Perry and Nelson Julian. And I don't think they're going to make it, because we've got another attack off the front of the peloton. And Charlie Tanfield has been caught out a little bit. There's a split in the back of the peloton. And Charlie Tanfield is starting to lose ground on the peloton. He got the lap, and now he's starting to lose the peloton. So gaining a lap, you know, if this keeps up, he could be losing a lap.
I can't even imagine that the level of fatigue in his legs right now, but you're right, the gap started to form, and now he's got work to do to get back up to make contact. But he looks like he's handling this in his usual calm nature now, just riding himself back on.
He is suffering. I think he will make it, but he is really, really suffering.
It hurts.
Will Perrott and Nielsen Julian still there. They're just about to be joined by Matty Dobbins for RT23. John Archibald now coming up. He senses that a lot of riders are starting to suffer, but Charlie Tanfield, he's leading this race, but he's hanging on the back of the peloton. He moves up to the top.
Goodness, yeah.
Legs are gone. He moves up to the top of the track. 45 laps to go. He can't go anymore.
He's made that decision. We saw him dangling there. I said he was completely under control riding back on, but what an effort he did to go for that lap. And he's decided that there's not that in the tank to keep chasing that group, and he's gone up to the top of the track.
Yeah, he's just taking a lap now. He wasn't going to make it. Is he going to drop in here? Yep, he's going to drop into the first. So the lap he took, he's now back. He's now lost that lap. And, we're three laps away to the next sprint. So the front of the race, we have got Matty Dobbins, Will Perrott and Nelson Julian. So three riders at the front of this race, followed by another four. Josh Tarling still in there for the pink. Then we have another five riders. I don't think there's going to be many left in this race.
It's absolutely split to pieces, and we'll look at confirmation in a moment and what that's done to the points tally.
I don't think I've ever seen that before. Rider take a lap and then all of a sudden, be brought back, lose that lap.
Absolutely.
So it has been brought back together. Charlie Tanfield has stopped, so he'll no longer be part of this race. So he's pulled up onto the apron. So Charlie Tanfield is out of this one. So that will shake things up. Josh Tarling, I would assume, would take control of this race now.
Yeah, it looks that way. Charlie Tanfield's decided there's absolutely nothing more he can do. He's sat up. So now that's Josh Tarling with 18 points. What a ride he's having. And followed by Oscar Nielsen Julian with 17 points. Will Perrott now holds 14. This is getting very, very exciting.
So it's going to be really close at the top there, unfortunately for Charlie Tanfield. But we do have a race. We have a really tight race. We will bring you up to speed with the points as soon as we have it. Difficult for the commissaires. They've got a BDI and things. But it's one of these races that's split all over the place. People gaining laps, losing laps. All to play for. 37 laps to go. It's all back together and very close at the top now.
It certainly is. So just to confirm after that sit-up by Charlie Tanfield, unfortunately, it is Josh Tarling that leads the way with 18 points. Everybody on the same lap now, it's worth noting, and Oscar Nielsen Jr. sits second with 17 points, Will Perrott with 14. An update below that. Fourth sits John Archibald with 9 points. Will Roberts has 7. Matty Dobbins has 3. Jack Brough has 2. Will Tidball behind him in the points as well. We're just having another update, catching up here on the points. Will Roberts now has 27 points because there was a lap gain. Will Tidball, 22 points and a lap. Carl Gordon, 20 points and a lap, putting them now into 1-2-3 in the tally. So that's Will Roberts leading the way after a lap gain, meaning he now sits with 27 points.
And another attack here from John Archibald with Josh Tarling. He knows that the riders just had a little bit of a lull there for a couple of laps, probably to take in the scoreboards, that they'll be able to look up and see, because if everybody's finding it hard to see where everybody is and didn't know about Charlie Tanfield, then, look at the scoreboard and, chasing them down is Nelson Julian. So John Archibald, Joshua Tarling, who's ridden incredible in this point race so far. They only have about a 20-metre advantage, but who's got... The riders got left in the legs. Three riders now at the front of the main group for Team Inspire, but they're not pushing on. A lot of fatigue in the legs now. So they'll get the belt this time with John Archibald in the lead. Josh Tarling, Will Perrott now deciding that he wants to gain some points here. Swings up the track a little bit. And he has got with them Jack Brough. So John Archibald, Josh Tarling. Josh Tarling, is he going to try and come around? No, he isn't. John Archibald, well, he is. It's going to be a close one. Yeah, Josh Tarling takes that, so takes the 5 points. And John Archibald takes the 3. Brough will take the 2 points on offer. The gap is coming down, but there's a lot of tired legs in there. I think Will Roberts was the rider that took the 1 point. So where do we stand now, Rebecca?
let me tell you. Well, that extra points tally for Josh Tarling moves him up to second with 23 points now, even though he's not made the lap gain. Oh, we're just seeing confirmation of things switch around all over the place. So I've got Josh Tarling there with 23 points. Oscar Nielsen Julian currently sitting second with 17. Will Perrott with 14.
Yeah, I never seen the three riders. They never took a lap. They were half a lap up and they were brought back. So.
Yeah, yeah,
I think we saw them make contact with part of the bunch that up their points tally, but it's actually gone back down to zero laps now. So just to confirm, that's Josh Tarlin with 23 points in the lead.
Yeah, he's got 6 points, and John Archibald is on 12 points, so he's got 11 points. But they have to concentrate in their race. 26 laps to go. We still have John Archibald and Josh Tarling in front, a Scot and a Welsh lad, and chasing them down. Will Perrott is there chasing, but there's no real cohesion behind. Two riders still hanging out there of Archibald and Josh Tarling, who's the leader of this event. Team Inspired have four riders in this group behind. Ben Wiggins still involved with the mix. Will Roberts is still there for Team Wales in the red. We're getting close to the last 20 laps. Team Inspired have to try and shut this one down, but this gap is going out a little bit now to John Archibald and Joshua Tarling. Looking a little bit better now, this gap going out. And it's Will Perrott. It's been forced. It's actually Kyle Gordon, his teammate, has been forced into doing a little bit of the chasing now. Will Perrott at the back of the main group. John Archibald comes through. Two laps in the next sprint. Joshua Tarling and John Archibald still leading this race. Now have half a lap. They had about 20 metres for about 4 or 5 laps. They'll come to the bell. John Archibald leading the way from Joshua Tarling. They have got one rider in tow who's also already been lapped, so he's just trying to gain something from it. But Josh Tarling will take the maximum points here from John Archibald. The next points coming around will go to Team Inspired, and that will be Josh Giddings taking the 2 points there. 19 laps to go. The rider in question taking a free ride there is Callum Twelves. He's already a lap down, so that's why he's just sitting on the back. Team Inspired being forced into the chase. Two riders trying to chase down the duo in front of Archibald and Josh Tarling. And with 18 laps to go, an update on the scores.
Happily, so it is Josh Tarling that still leads the way at the moment in this points race. He's got 28 points. Everybody is now on the same lap in terms of the top of the points tally. And we've got 9 riders sitting who've taken points. We've got second place currently, 17 points, which is Oscar Nielsen-Julian, and John Archibald has 15 points in third, but closely behind in the points stakes is Will Perrott with 14.
So it's Kyle Gordon and Nielsen-Julian trying to chase down the duo off the front of the main group. But it's Tarling and Archibald now. They've got about a quarter of a lap to make up, to gain their lap. But Nielsen-Julian and Kyle Gordon are about half a lap behind them. So looking good for Josh Tarling for this title. John Archibald, perfect rider to have company. They've got half a lap on Gordon and Nielsen-Julian. So Josh Tarling coming through with Archibald going down the back straight. And you'll see the group in front of them. But Kyle Gordon and Nielsen-Julian have half a lap on the peloton, and it does look as if, and what did they do here? Do they hold back or do they take the lap? Because we have got a sprint coming up the next time round, they'll hear the bell.
I just think that's such an age-old question, because actually you just desperately want to make contact with the bank. But if you can do both, if you can sit out there just long enough to take those points and then make contact, that's perfect. But obviously the benefit, the advantage of getting back on is huge. But I'd imagine they want to take these points and the lap.
Yeah, well, I don't think they've got any question about that. So Josh Tarling takes the maximum points there from John Archibald. So they weren't going to make it on a matter of about 20, 30 metres. And then we have Kyle Gordon and Nelson Julian. So we're inside the last 10 laps. We do have double points in the final lap. And I think with the map, the lap taken now from Josh Tarling now and John Archibald, they will gain 20 points. An attack off the front now from Jack Buff, but we still have two riders here with Kyle Gordon and Nelson Julian.
Well, that was a definite catch, a definite lap gain, and it is Josh Tarling now one lap up, which means he now sits with 53 points in the lead with a great buffer. John Archibald sits second, 38, because he's also gained the lap, and then in third place is Oscar Nilsson Jr. with 19 points.
Well, six laps to go. We have got a rider off the front of the main group, Jack Brough, but you can also see Kyle Gordon and Nelson Julian there. I don't think they're going to make it. They're at the front of the race now. And they're possibly just under half a lap down. They have got four laps to be able to close that to get the 20 points, but there is a bit of speed about this group. I don't think they're going to make it now. So four laps to go for the two riders that lead this group.
Well, there's three medals up to for grabs, of course, and it's very close behind with Oscar Nilsson Julian with 19 points on zero laps, and Will Perrett with 14 on zero laps. We've got double points on the line. Will Roberts there in contention with 8 points, and Jack Brough has got 5.
Well, looking at this, barring any incident, I think Josh Tarling, right from the start on the attack, looked magnificent through this race, rode the perfect race, looks as if he could be our new national champion. John Archibald went with him, took that lap, and it's looking good. But also, just as we say this, you can see that Kyle Gordon and Nelson Julian have just taken their lap, so at 20 points to their tally, with only so it's all together coming up to the bell lap, double points, but I don't think it'll have any significance in the winner of this race.
Josh Tarling with that buffer, 53 points, a lap up at the moment. Four people have gained a lap in this race.
So just coming up to the finish of the points race here, and it's a close one. Jack Brough and close one with the Welsh rider there, Will Robertson. But there's no doubt in the new champion, the youngster from Wales, Josh Tarling, is taking his first points race title. So he'll be the new national champion in scintillating style. He's looking around. I don't think he realises.
He needs confirmation of that. He's not convinced he's taken it. Look at that.
But there's a lot of chopping and changing, yeah, and people gaining laps, but I don't think he realises that. He's gone, did I win that?
Have I got it? Have I got it? He's pointing to himself there. Yeah, I mean, you could hear my frantically trying to tally here in the commentary box. And for the riders out there, keeping track of, did someone make contact at the back? Were they still dangling out there? Did they just get double points? And you could see him questioning, did I take it?
Yeah, Will Roberts just taking the, just rolling over Jack Brough there, taking the 10 points, but that wouldn't make any distance difference to the tally of Josh Tarling. So, absolutely fantastic race here. Very difficult to keep up with where everybody was, but it does look as if Josh Tarling is our new winner. Looks like Oscar Nilsson Julian will take silver, and John Archibald will take the bronze, only 1 point in it. So with the Welsh flag, this lad has a big future ahead of him. That was the way he played that. When we saw the first attacks and he went with it, gained the points, put himself there. And sometimes when you gain these points, Rebecca, you want to kind of duck and dive and just follow. No, he was up there, took that lap. Charlie Tanfield, wow, he just bang, went out there, you know, took that lap, but really, really paid for it and never finished the race.
I think that was just such an impressive ride, wasn't it, from Josh Tarling. And yeah, from start to finish, he didn't sit back, he didn't watch and mark, and he just took absolutely every opportunity to jump straight onto that move early on, but then backed it up time and time again, and as I say, never sat in. Just kept animating that race right through to the end, and even looked in disbelief that he did have the buffer that he did.
I can sit down now. I spent that whole race standing up.
Oh, you certainly did. My goodness me, what a race. That was not short of moves, was it?
No, I was... That was a tough race. That was all over the place. You know, hard for the judges to keep the score of what was happening, but, you know, this rider here, Josh Tarling, we knew he had a talent. We knew that at the World Championships last year on the road, and, mm-hmm. you know, everybody was talking about him.
He just keeps shaking his head, doesn't he, almost in disbelief that he's done it. It will start to sink in now.
You've got 5 minutes before ceremony down that end.
Right, come on, hurry up. Don't you ask. 5 minutes, get ready.
Let's get you on that podium.
So there's confirmation. Josh Tarling, 53 points. Oscar Nelson-Julian, 39 points. John Archibald on 38 points. Only 1 point of a difference between. They were the only three riders, according to the scoreboard, or four riders now. They gave Kyle Gordon their lap towards the end, as well as Oscar Julian, Nelson-Julian. And that was that lap gain. They caught them with one lap to go that yep. just nipped in there for Oscar Nelson-Julian to take that silver medal. I think John Archibald, silver, bronze. You know, he was always out there to kind of try and win, but just taking that lap with one lap to go made the difference there. So Kyle Gordon, valiant effort from the Scot there, but pushed out the medals, and we will see the gold medal go to Wales with Josh Tarling, Oscar Julian, Nelson-Julian. That's three names. Oscar Nelson-Julian taking silver, and John Archibald, the Scot, taking the bronze medal.
And I think we need to add context as well, don't we, to that top three, because actually we kept saying that John Archibald hasn't had the track time coming in. He's had other focuses. And, to put himself into the bronze medal position there, I mean, he fought the whole way. What a brilliant ride. And Oscar Nelson-Julian sitting second, taking 39 points in the end. Again, he just never gave up belief that he could keep coming back and do what he did.
I need to take a couple of minutes, just calm
you
after that.
You need to recover after that.
Calm.
You deserve a rest.
I even got a sweat on. So we're moving on to the men's sprints, the second leg. First up, we'll see the bronze medal ride between Hamish Turnbull and Hayden Norris. Hamish Turnbull won the first leg. Can Norris make it 1-1 and go to a decider?
Enough that Jason Kenny, in his usual modesty, has just gone straight back in, hasn't he, to helping everybody else, to focusing on the riders as a sprint coach now on the men's podium programme.
So at the top of the track, you have Hamish Turnbull, and he's inside. You have Hayden Norris, and Hayden Norris will lead the way. And he has to win this one to make it go to a decider for the bronze medal. Norris and Turnbull. A very slow and cagey start.
Cagey is a good word for it, isn't it? Two teammates, team inspired, looking at each other.
Nope,
Here we go.
Aidan Norris had to do something special, and is this something special? I'm not too sure it is. I think he's going to swing up now. He tried it. Good that he tried it. Didn't work.
He tried, didn't he? Had a look. Is it working? No, not going to commit to that one.
Oh, that's you get. That's what you get for trying. One lap to go, and now he's forced to Turnbull. Turnbull is at the front, into the back straights. Can Norris do this? He put a bit of an effort in there to try and surprise. Not too sure here. Turnbull coming down the home straights. Yeah, he just doesn't have the power there. So Turnbull will take the bronze medal in the men's sprint. Hayden Norris will be in fourth, probably the worst spot after all the effort of getting to this ride-off. But I don't think he could have done anything better in this race. He tried to come down the outside, but Hamish Turnbull just had too much power in the end and takes that bronze medal.
And I don't think you can say fairer than that, can you? You know, this has been such a hard battle, consistently coming back, and it could have gone potentially to a decider, but, you know, Turnbull took two of three, meaning it doesn't need to go to that third match, of course. But, yeah, I think that's all you can say, really, going away with fighting every way that you possibly can.
So next up, this is for the gold medal. Jack Carling, 1-0 up. Joe Truman needs to win this one. He is in the outside of the track.
Yeah, of course, Jack Carling will want to take this one so that it's two rides. He sealed the deal and that's done. But of course, Joe Truman, he'll want to take race two and push this and push Jack Carlin to a decider.
I think Jack Carlin will want to put a show on here. He'll want to own the track. He's got that confidence. He's willing to take the risk. We've already seen it, diving into that sprinter's lane. Some people will not do that. He did, and, you know, it paid off for him. You know, when he was in it, Joe Truman couldn't go in it and had to go the long way around. So I think we're going to see a nice bit of spicy sprinting.
Jack Carlin certainly gives the spice to sprinting, doesn't he? And that absolute commitment to dive down below the red early, that was just phenomenal to watch. But Joe Truman, wanting to put up a fight, wants to win race two. Just not quite taking that walking pace into the banking, which you don't want to do.
Now we're high in the track is Truman. He'll need to use the height to gain speed if he wants to try and beat Carling. Carling wanted to hold that front spot. But Truman straight over the top. Good move there. Caught Jack Carling napping a little bit. Carling a little bit to do. Coming up to the bell. Jack Carling is a lot to do here. And Truman did the right thing, but punching into that gap. You can see down the back straight. Wow, just look at the power of Jack Carling. Straight into the gap, slingshot pass, and takes the title. Oh. That was just sheer speed and class. Jack Carling, the new sprint champion of Great Britain.
Well, what a worthy victor to take another national jersey. You heard the reaction of the crowd there. So pleased for Jack Carling, but equally, oh, that move from Joe Truman. I think, you know, people, oh, is it going to pay off? But Jack Carling just coming back with the prowess that he had, of course, never panicking. And Truman did everything he could there, but Carling just has it this weekend.
Joe Truman is a quality rider, and down the back straight there, he was putting the power down, and like a rocket, it's like he really is. He was shot out a cannon, straight down the back. Okay, he never did the same round the banking, into the finishing straight, and bang, had enough power to finish it off. You know, incredible talent, as we know. Silver medalist at Tokyo, and, you know, let's see what he can do in Paris up against the rest of the world, but a world-class sprinter.
Oh, he truly is. And he puts on a show for us as well, doesn't he?
Where's he from again, Brian?
Let me think.
Do you know?
Paisley. Paisley. I bumped into him at breakfast yesterday and we talked to him. I said, you go back home much? And he said, no, he's from the kind of other side of Paisley. And we just had a wee bit of a natter. I said I was a St Mirren fan. I'm going up there in a couple of weeks' time to watch the team as a guest of the chairman. He said that, yeah, he was there, but he's more of a Rangers fan than a St Mirren fan. So I just said, look, I really liked you at the start, but I don't like you now. So, yeah, he's a lot of the youngsters nowadays, they have the, they support the local team, but then they want to support the best teams. So he has been a few St Mirren matches, so I'll lay off him a little bit since he's the new champion. So what do these lights mean?
They mean it's Saturday night here live in the Geraint Thomas Velodrome. That's what it means.
It does mean we are going to a medal ceremony. Packed out crowds, loving the track cycling. And I was just talking to a few people as well, just, you know, about the seating. It's 500 capacity here. It was meant to be a training venue rather than an event venue. As we look at the women's scratch race. And the bronze medal going to Team Hub with Nia Evans to add to our medal collection. And the silver medal going to Anna Morris of Team Wales. Tried to come round the long way down the finishing straight. She's ridden strongly in these events over the last couple of days.
Yeah, Anna Morris has been really, really impressive, hasn't she? Across yesterday, throughout the duration and today.
And the winner and the gold medal goes to Wales and Ella Barnwell of Cairns Basel. So Wales 1-2. Just remind everybody that Anna Morris is a qualified doctor, taking a year out to try and get to the Commonwealth Games. She worked all of lockdown in ICU. So a tremendous effort. So an appreciative crowd here in Newport in South Wales. And the Welsh have done well, haven't they, so far in the first couple of days?
They certainly have, and the pride to take these jerseys in front of a local crowd at home velodrome, yeah, it's very, very special indeed. It'll be a very proud moment for her.
So Ella Barnwell taking gold, Anna Morris silver, and Nia Evans taking the bronze medal. Scotland, Wales and Wales. Where's England? Oh, we're just having a wee bit of jest about that, because looking at the Commonwealth Games coming up, and I believe that the team sprints, they're going to be kind of split, you know, kind of Scotland, Wales and England as kind of preparation towards. And we're going to listen to the new champion, Ella Barnwell.
Congratulations, well done. Can you talk us through how that race went for you tonight?
Yeah, it was a pretty mad race, very cagey, and, you know, it was a long sprint, so it was very nerve-wracking, but, you know, I was able to pull it off in the end, so really happy with that.
Great, well done. And how does it feel to get the national champs jersey on again?
Yeah, it feels amazing, like, as well being in Newport, home track, so it's, like, really proud to get the stripes here.
Great, well, they should have it here every year, should they?
Yep, definitely.
Congratulations again, well done.
Cheers, thank you.
I think they should ask for that. when you consider that Leicester had it for many, many years, from 73 to 94. Manchester had it from 95 to 2020. Why not here in Newport, Wales?
Well, it's certainly working for the Welsh, isn't it?
At least I can come here and do the park run at Newport, which is only a kilometre away from the hotel.
You're happy with that, yeah.
So the men's points race, and the winner of the bronze medal, John Archibald, one of only four riders that took a lap. He actually took a lap with the eventual winner, Josh Tarling.
Winner of the silver medal, representing Team Inspired, Oscar Nilsson Julian.
And the silver medal going to...
Oscar Nilsson Julian. Taking the silver medal, just beaming there. Really, really good ride from him.
He did do well. He was up there earlier on. He was very active. But talking about talent in this race, Josh Tarling, the local young rider, huge prospect up there right from the first few laps to the end, taking the lap, was challenged, lost his lead. And then Charlie Tanfield pulled out, couldn't do it. This man persevered and takes the national title. Josh Tarling, riding for his Belgian team. Another Welsh win, another Welsh podium.
Another Welsh win, and what a moment as he pulls on that such coveted national jersey. Those stripes, that medal. And this is his moment to soak in after, from start to finish, the most stunning level of attacking we could possibly see in a points race. See the emotions there.
Yeah, this is his home. Josh Tarling, Oscar Nilsson Julian, John Archibald. You know, these are quality riders, and you could just see, I think, a little bit of emotion, and you know, he's granted that, possibly a little bit stunned, if I'm honest, seeing his reaction after the race. This won't sink in possibly until tomorrow. I know he's done well before, he's done well at the World Championships, but I think as we hear him afterwards, this is pretty special for a young man to do this, you know, his home velodrome in Wales, in front of a Welsh crowd, and with, you know, other exceptional talented athletes. So Alistair's just grabbed him, he's just off the podium. He has 5 minutes to cool down. So here's your new winner, Joshua Tarling.
Josh, congratulations. Yeah, you led from start to finish pretty much. Sounds simple, but talk us through it. It was probably anything but.
I knew it would be fast because there's quite a lot of people on like really big gears, and there's like big engines like John Archibald and like Will Perrott and stuff. So I knew I was going to ride a little bit of a smaller gear, and I just wanted to get the jump. And I knew the gear would come back, so I thought I'd go early while it was just fresh. And luckily, I think I stayed out for two sprints, and I think that sort of gave me that lead. And then I could sort of sit on for a bit and just sort of collect small points. And then I think luckily, when John went, and I was on him, I knew like he's such a big engine, and I was parking it every time I was on the front, but I just knew that if I could stick with him, the chances are it's going to stay for a decent time.
Fantastic, well done. And what's next for you from here?
Scratch racing TP tomorrow, so yeah, got to try and back up, and I don't want to let Wales down, so try and get some good recovery in, and then yeah, try and sub for tomorrow.
Best of luck for that, and congratulations again.
Cheers, thank you.
Parking up, what does that mean, Rebecca? You parked up.
Do you think this is our age?
Well, it means that, you know, whenever he was forced to go through to the front, because he was absolutely suffering like anybody on John Archibald's wheel, because he is a big engine. As soon as John Archibald went up the track and he had to do his turn, he was like, he felt as if he'd stopped. But if you asked John Archibald, he would have probably said the same thing about Josh. It's a mind game. You think, oh, you're really, really suffering. It really is a mind game. So we're moving on to the women's Kieran minor place final. And it's going to be Amy Cole, Ellie Costa, Iona Moyer, Serena Natt, Lucia Steele, and Lowry Thomas. And that will be from 7 to 12. And for the first time today, we can pick out the riders in red. And the Derny man.
Do you think a rider in red might take the victory here, Brian?
I'm going for the Derny this time. So this is for 7th to 12th. It looks like Nat will be the rider on the Derny. Lucia Steele in third place, Team Breeze, Scottish rider. Iona Moyer also in the mix, so Nat on the bike. And this is a little bit for bragging rights than anything else. So Nat from Moyer, Steele, looking behind. So the Derny will wind up to 45 kilometres an hour before it peels off with three laps to go. Movement from the back already. Derny peels off, Nat still on the front, but moving up right from the back to the front, Lowry Thomas. Lucia Steele now comes over the top, she doesn't want to be caught out, she wants to finish as high as possible. She gains height, two laps to go, and Steele is there. She gains a couple of metres, not fully going full gas for the time being. Just waiting, now she goes. The bell lap, Nat trying to come over the top. Lucia Steele holding the bottom line. Can she hold on down the back straight? Not over the top. Comes Ellie Costa. Ellie Costa looks as if she's going to take seventh place here. It's a battle for the minor places. Ellie Costa takes seventh there. So that was a really nice effort there from Ellie Costa over the top. At the right time, I think Lucia Steele kind of propped on the front a little bit too early there, but and really nice there. You should see it now, the power down the back straight, Lucia Steele in the inside. Moyer also going over the top for SES Racing. She'll take the eighth place, coming in out of turn four, and Costa has this under control. Other riders are just missing that little bit. So 7th for Ellie Costa, Moyer will take the 8th, 9th for Lucia Steele.
Yeah, first across the line there for Welsh rider Ellie Costa. And that was, of course, the ride off for 7th to 12th places. And we've said time and time again how important it is for these riders to not only go for the victory, but actually to look at where they're at in this competition. We missed it last year. They're back. They're seeing for the first time with a number on their back where perhaps their training has led them over the last year or so. And yeah, it'll be really important for these riders to put in their best rides here at the championships with so many more objectives as well throughout the year.
Well, we go on to our last competition of the evening. I hope you've enjoyed the action so far. It's been a fast and furious night here in Newport in the women's final. Will be between Lauren Bell, Sophie Capewell, Rhiann Edmonds, Emma Funican, Stephanie Hull and Ellie Stone. Who's your money on?
Well, you know what I'm going to go
Welsh
do?
Welsh not riding.
Sorry?
Welsh not riding.
I'm going back to my list of 200 metre times because I like to look on paper. I know it's not all
then
about.
You want to go with Edmonds?
I know it's not all about what's on paper. Do you know who I think really, really wants this? Of course, all these competitors want it, but I think the rider that went away with a silver medal, slightly dissatisfied yesterday, was Sophie Katewell of Team Breeze. She wants that national jersey on her shoulders at the end of today. This is the last event of the evening of this session, and Sophie Katewell very much wants this. It was her and Rhian Edmonds that went under 11 seconds yesterday in their qualifying time, so both doing a 10.9 something, and yeah, Rhian Edmonds took the gold medal yesterday in the individual. Sophie Katewell really, really wants this, but you know, the battle is on. This superb talent in this final. They fought through repechages to get here. Some were qualifying straight through to semi-finals, but what a battle we have on our hands here as the journey just starts to wind it up with five laps to go.
Well, if you're going for Sophie Capewell, I have to go with local girl. I think she was maybe holding back a little bit in the previous. She hasn't had to go through a repechage. She's had one ride straight into the semi-final. She just had to finish first three. She only lives 15 minutes up the road. And that's Rhian Edmonds. I know she's got a lot of support here. She won yesterday the sprint. She's sitting in second place. And I think she is the one to beat in this one. But I think maybe the experience of the others might count, because Edmonds is only 18 years old. So she's just learning this craft. And this is a craft to learn, this Kieran racing. Looking behind and making sure you're not riding into the rider in front of you, but I think Edmonds will want to take this one on from the front.
And calming the nerves, calming the edginess. You know, these riders are so well versed in this event, but equally, anything can happen in a split second at any time to derail you, and that's why we see the riders looking around so much and refining what they're doing. So they don't want to be caught out, they don't want to be caught napping, especially in this company.
Straight over the top now, as we can see, Black Line deciding to go for this early, and she's opening up quite an extensive gap here, and a big chase behind. So Ellie Stone has got a bit of a march, and now comes Rhian Edmonds. Can Rhian Edmonds catch her down the finishing straight? It's not going to be. Rhian Edmonds going to get second, so it's Ellie Stone that takes it. Ellie Stone surprises everybody. She did this in the repechage, and amazing there from Ellie Stone. Surprised everybody, no surprise to her, but Ellie Stone from Black Line takes that one and is the new Kieran champion of Britain. Look at her go down the back straight. She showed such power, and it's not, you know, look at the reaction of the others. She gains about two bike lengths, left it all to do, and you know, they were coming the whole way down the finishing straight. Looks like it was Kate while it was up there in the third place, but wow, I think that upset a few people. Ellie Stone, Black Line, takes it, and deservedly so. She did this twice in a row, and she wins the national Kieran title quite convincingly there.
Well, my goodness, Ellie Stone, what a ride. She played that to perfection. Competitors ran out of time to get that gap down to where they needed it to be. And yeah, you can see the confirmation of the result there. Ellie Stone taking that national championship jersey, that gold medal in the women's Kieran. And as you say, Brian, I think she knew she could do that. Look at that smile.
Not a huge reaction. She's just taking it in her stride, smiling. But that was really good power there from Ellie Stone. Just went at the right time down the back straight and had enough power to fend the others off. Well deserved.
Very well deserved. And it is all about a mixture of every element coming together, isn't it? You've got to have put those training hours in. You've got to know that you've got that strength, that fitness, that ability coming into, you know, a championship like this. But also you've got to keep your head on, and that's exactly what she did. She didn't panic. She moved when she knew she could, and she held it, and that was spectacular.
Just looking back in the results of the Kieran. In heat two, she was beaten by Rhian Edmonds. So she was second in heat two. Had to come through the repechage and won the title. So we move on to the Men's Sprints Award Ceremony. With the bronze medal going to Hamish Turnbull of Team Inspired. And the silver medal goes to Joseph Truman, also of Team Inspired. And your 2022 British Sprint Champion is Jack Carling, again from Team Inspired. So a clean sweep as expected, four of them into the semi-finals. And Jack Carling came out on top. Can't say he didn't deserve it.
Oh, you really can't. I mean, he came in as the favourite, executed his game plan to perfection, and looked like he had a lot of fun in the process as well, actually, just showing that absolute dominance. And what a display of power in every sense of the word from Jack Carling. He can enjoy this moment.
That top looks a little bit big for him. Had to roll it up. So Jack Carling, your new men's sprint champion. Joe Truman, second in silver medal. And Hamish Turnbull with the bronze. And no doubt, we'll hear from the boy from Paisley. And it's not me. Jack Carling will be with Alistair in a moment. Just stay with us. We still have one other medal ceremony to go, and that is the women's Kieran, which we've just seen. So Jack Carling is now with Alistair.
Jack, congratulations. Yes, Team Inspired have dominated the sprint competition today. So how much of a rivalry is there and how good does it feel to come out on top?
We all ride for the same team. We're trying to accumulate points so that we can go into the Nations Cups further on down the line. And we've came here and we've got what we wanted from... so far, we'll still get the Kieran tomorrow. But really pleased with today. It's nice to have a time off after the Olympics and then come back, and the two races that I've done in the sprint so far, I've managed to come on top, so fingers crossed it carries on.
Well done, and what's your next big goal from here?
So as a team, it will be the Nations Cups, which is in Glasgow on the end of April, so that will be the next big goal for the team, and then obviously later down the line's Commonwealth, so I think it's all to play for this year, and yeah, I've got my mojo back and I'm enjoying the racing, so yeah, I'm looking forward to getting stuck in for the rest of the year.
Great. Well, all the best. Good luck with the rest of the year.
Cheers, mate.
Congratulations again.
Cheers. Thank you.
I think with that voice, he'll make a good commentator one day. What do you think?
It is a lovely accent. It really is.
You're just saying that because I'm sat next to you.
Well, my partner's from that part of the world, so I am. I'm not going to say I'm not biased.
Posh Paisley accents. So just bear with us. We are going to see... It's just finished the Kieran for the woman. Would you say a surprise?
Yeah, well, I think maybe we had... Was it commentator's curse? No, it was a really, really deserved victory. But again,
victory, I think, but
massively.
Maybe a bit of a surprise.
It was a very deserved victory. But again, I know I roll out these cliches sometimes, but looking on paper again, she wasn't the fastest coming in, but you just couldn't argue with that. And look at that hug with Sophie Kate. Well, you know, that just goes to show, you know, at this level of competition, there is nothing given away, and she deserved every inch of that. But yeah, I think she probably probably turned a few heads. She probably surprised a few people.
Where was she in the qualifying for the sprint yesterday?
Yeah, so I was looking down and she was 10th in qualification on the 200 actually yesterday with a time of 11.307. And obviously we are looking at close times. It's not like we've got huge gaps here. I mean, what a qualification time she did. But then if you look at on paper at Evans and Capewell, who went sub 11, you might have picked them out. Well, we did pick them out. But yeah, a very, very deserving victory from Ellie Stone. But yeah, I think she turned some heads and will continue to do so.
Just get told the order of the ceremony. Team Breeze staying at our hotel. We were having breakfast where Sophie Capewell was just pretty much next to us. Did you notice what she was eating?
I generally notice that everybody eats so healthily, and you know what it makes me think, right, maybe I will just go for the healthy cereal and steer away from the other things. But yeah, definitely they're healthy choices, especially when they've got to recover and come back and do all this again on another day, like we've seen many competitors do from yesterday to today, and indeed we've got plenty more coming up tomorrow.
So the bronze medal going to Team Breeze, and that is Sophie Capewell. She's ridden consistently through these championships already. Don't write her off, still got something to prove in the events tomorrow. Emma Finucane from Team Wales taking the silver medal. With the gold medal going to Ellie Stone from the Black Line team. Had to come through the repechage. Was beaten in the qualifying by Rhianne Edmonds, the local girl. And a very well-deserved national champs jersey for her, Ellie Stone. Just taking it all in, taking it on her stride.
She is, isn't she? The crowd just applaud, and she steps up onto that podium in first position. Jersey and medal on her shoulders, and she gets to enjoy this victory.
Proud moment for anybody. So, arms around each other. Ellie Stone takes the gold. Emma Finucane the silver, and Sophie Capewell takes bronze. And you can just bear with us because we'll have a little chat with our new champion. Hopefully we'll find out more about what she thinks of taking that jersey.
Yeah, it'll be interesting to get her reaction, won't it?
She's just had a hug from Jack Carlin there. So here she is, Ellie.
Okay. Congratulations, you led that out from a long way. How good did it feel to get back over the line and win the race?
So good, honestly, like, I was going along, like, literally going, they're going to catch me any minute now, and they just didn't. I was getting closer, I was like, oh my God! It was so good. My coach was just like, find the black line and hold it, and I was like, okay, here I go.
Well done, well, you really held them off. Had you planned to go that early, or was it just something that happened?
My coach was like, with two laps to go, be like, looking to go. And then I saw two and I was like, right, seat rest, up, go. And I was like, I'm just going to keep going. And I don't think any of them saw me or expected me to go. So they were just kind of looking at me like, oh, no, she'll go around. I'll get going. I was like, go. Because I knew there's such a strong fear. Like, I completely expected to come first and everyone to roam and end up stuck at the back. But
You won the race fair and square. Well done. What's next for you from here?
I got 500 tomorrow and I get a team sprint ride with some of the girls that I was racing just then. So that's really exciting.
Great. Well, best of luck with that and congratulations again.
Thank you so much.
I think it's just wonderful to see. I think she's still in the race. She's still still looking, still that feeling, you know, a bit surprised, but no surprise to us. She really deserved that. So
I loved that interview.
Your last thoughts on today, Rebecca?
Well, I think some of the raw emotional interviews that we've seen have just been absolutely brilliant. And, just to finish off with her reaction there and just animating her way again, reliving that race. I don't think anyone saw me. That's what I love about these national track championships. And, it's been a spectacular couple of days already and more to come.
Well, we've had some cracking racing. We still have got some more racing tomorrow to come, so we all look forward to that. I hope you've enjoyed tonight's racing here at the Newport Velodrome. More tomorrow. Why don't you join us?